Chair.
Yes. All righty. We need peace, gentlemen, Mr. LaBranch, everybody, we need.
He needs about 1 minute after.
Hello, we're on camera, gentlemen, now, now. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This work session of the Municipal Budget Committee is called to order at 7 p.m. on January 5, 2017. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
Introducing the members of the Budget Committee from the viewer's right.
Regina Barnes, Board of Selectmen rep.
Ginny Bridle, School Board rep.
Mike Pierce, Taxpayers rep.
Hunter Kravitz.
Brian Lobham.
Steve Anderson.
Mike Flo.
Danielle Augustine.
Jones, Voters rep.
David Mara.
Stephen LaBranch. Bob Ladd, Village District rep.
And our secretary is Barbara Kravitz. Let's see. Mr. Pierce, did you need?
No, not right now.
Not right now. Okay. We have revised figures from the finance office on the fire supervisors contract. The Budget Committee did have some misgivings about the dollar amounts there, and the finance office has the amounts so that they are probably more accurate. So you each have a copy, and we appreciate that.
I do have a question about that.
Yes, sir.
If the firefighters union, supervisors union was, and they don't get steps and all that sort of thing, was the one that sort of stood out to us because it was easy to sort of figure out.
Microphone.
The $30,000 increase in salary in 3 years per person seemed a little ridiculous. So if there was that mistake made on that one, what makes us think there is some problems with the rest of them is my question.
Well, that's...
We need to have somebody clarify what went wrong to start with and then why we ended up where we were. If we could have somebody do that, that'd be marvelous.
Do we have an answer?
Of you all of the union contracts to answer Mr. Pierce's question. What happened when we compounded it originally, we included in charges such as incentives that were are part of the bargaining contracts, but when we re-looked at them, we realized they should not be compounded because they're once a year, whereas the compounding should only be of the wages. So if you look at the chart in front of you now, it's separated into two sections as opposed to the one section that you had before.
Good.
Showing that on the top half, the top chart shows salaries, wages, pay increases, along with overtime, and then the benefit charges that go along with that, and then that's compounded out over on the right. And then the chart underneath it shows the one-time, once the expenditures or incentives that are granted once a year, such as I believe in the 3017, they have incentives in now there now for education. Jamie had gone over all those when he was here. And the other incentive in there, I think, was for...
Can you see your charts real quick?
Yeah, I have those. Okay. And then on 3017, they had... Oh, and then the prescription plan changes for... the prescription plan pool, because in 2018, the unions are going to have to choose a new prescription plan. So we had put in $8,000 for that. So those once a year expenditures, we broke out and did not compound those. And then therefore that accounts for the changes in the numbers. And we did go back and revisit all of them. And you have all four of them in front of you tonight.
Excellent.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
We don't have that a compounding effect in any of the other union contracts.
Well, that's what
we have the compounding effect in all the unions. That's why the charts look the same on every page. The top part shows the wages and the base salaries plus any overtime. And then the chart on the bottom shows if they had any other types of incentives that were just once a year. Every chart that you have should have two. Each union, each page represents a union. They tell you what union on the top. Right. And then underneath it, you have the one that you can see that's compounded out. And then the other one you can tell that it's not compounded out because it's just one total for each year as opposed to the totals adding and compounding down.
Right. I appreciate that. So that you've broken them all out so you won't have that possible problem on any of them.
Yes, that is accurate.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Christy. I appreciate
that. And if you go back and look at the stuff you were given previously, you will see that these are all new numbers.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you
very much, Christy. I appreciate
that. We will be revisiting this to make the correction on the Warren article before the public hearing. So I'm going to ask all of you to be present at the Academy cafeteria at 6:30 p.m. on Thursday the 12th so that we can take care of this. And there are a couple of other odds and ends that we're going to need to take care of as a committee. So this will be presented properly to the public, and I'm sure the town pass outs will accommodate this corrected information. Yeah. So I will be sending out to you a reminder to show up, please, at 6:30 p.m.
We have to notify the public
next
also.
Thursday. Well, the public isn't going to be there. I mean, we're going to be sitting there in public.
It's a public meeting.
So the budget committee is going to start their meeting at 6:30.
Just
and then the public hearing will start at 7.
Yeah.
So it's a non-public meeting then?
Oh, it was a public meeting.
We're going to be doing it in public, but it's not.
A public meeting followed by the public hearing.
Yeah.
Well, public, I understand the public hearing part.
Previous years we've done this, and we've always started at 7 anyway.
We didn't start
at 7. No.
If you want to start at 6:30,
I'm only asking a historical question.
We have.
I just want to make sure that the public
we just want to make sure
what,
that this, and the documents that will be available for people to take from the table as they walk in will reflect the new calculations that Christy has made. Okay. Are we set with any other?
Could I just 6:30, I make one comment?
Yes, sir.
I handed out to everyone an article from Manchester Union Leader about gas prices. You might want to check. Mm-hmm. And I also handed out, thanks to the treasurer for the Village District, they're up-to-date numbers.
And we will be doing the annual Hampton Beach Village District, annual budget at our regular budget meeting in February. Okay, great. Then this evening's agenda, which has been posted, is the final pieces of the budget. And the first section is the section for the town manager. Oh, by the way, so the public knows, after, what? Yes, minutes too. Wait 1 second. The committee has been provided with the IT report, and every individual has received a pass out on that. We requested that a while ago, and that has come through. Let's see, the minutes of December 8th, Barbara?
Right.
Okay, I will accept, Barbara has emailed these, and I sent all of you, I think, a little note saying, please read before Thursday. Are there corrections to be made? I'll accept a motion first from Mr. Plouffe, seconded by Mr. Pierce, to approve the minutes of December 8th. Anyone have any corrections? There appearing to be none in favor of accepting the minutes. Okay. And opposed? Abstaining? Oh, you were not. Okay. Thank you.
And I'm abstaining.
Just two abstaining.
And Mr. Ladd is abstaining. Well, you both are abstaining because you were not present.
Brian?
Oh, okay. So three were not present. So Lapham, LaBranch, and Jones are abstaining because...
No, I'm...
I mean Ladd. Lapham, Ladd, and, well, you two are sitting so close. Lapham, Ladd, and Jones were not present. Okay, we have...
Sure. Did you guys already approve the minutes of December 1?
Yes.
I wasn't attending.
Well, that was...
All the other minutes are done.
But Barbara, I would like to note that I do have changes in some of the phraseology associated with me to those minutes. And I'm not sure exactly how I'll go about making that happen. But if I can't, I would like that recorded in this meeting.
Oh, okay. What's the purpose?
The 12 1-minute has a motion. The IT subcommittee from 6. Incorrectly stated. It was asked for the audit report from Tom Anderson. That's the correct statement.
Well, Barbara,
taken right off the video.
Barbara can make a note of that now and incorporate that correction into these minutes because we've already approved the December 1st minutes. So do you have the exact wording that she should...
Give it to her.
Oh, that's it? Okay. You're all set?
That's
okay,
the motion.
Thank you very much.
On December 6th, there's a statement. I don't want to run too fast for her. There's a statement about the conservation warrant article where it read that I pointed out that some money was currently available, which is correct, and commended changing the name of the fund to better express the purpose. Actually, I asked Regina to express to the Board of Selectmen my happiness at the improved at the improved wording, and got rid of the offensive, inaccurate name of land acquisition fund that had been used for previous years, because such a fund does not exist. That's what I said.
All right, excellent. I'm sure everybody is all...
I'm all happy to have all of that adjusted, I know.
Thank you.
And there's one more which I don't want to cause too much upset, so I'll just like let it slide.
Okay, excellent. Now, we are on executive, which includes, we have done the Board of Selectmen. We have the manager.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion to move the town manager's budget.
Okay, wait a second.
Second.
I just want to get my total page here so I know what we're doing. Okay.
OBS 1.
I know, but we have a couple of iterations here. I want to make sure I'm doing it right.
For $288,487.
$487.
I'll second it.
Lapham seconded already.
Okay, discussion. I'll start on the left side. Do we have a discussion? Questions? Anything? Over on my right? Anyone have any observations?
I have a general question, if you will, Madam Chair.
All righty.
Now, reviewing the NHMA video a couple years ago, which was most enlightening to revisit. I encourage others to watch again, even those who were present, where we learned that NHMA was a lobbying group. And I also learned that during that meeting that the school committee has a lobbying group. And the town clerk has a lobbying group. Hmm? And the town manager has a lobbying group. And I'm just wondering, in the context of this question, on the motion, do we pay dues to the town manager's association, I guess it's called?
All those associations are paid dues under the statute, yes.
So it's under your town manager budget?
That's correct.
Okay, how much is that?
$200.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that.
So I just wanted to get clarity on that.
Yes?
What is the amount you said?
$100.
$200.
$100, he said $100.
It says $200 on page one.
There's two managers, so it's $200, one for each. He asked me how much I paid.
I was asking how much we paid, but that's okay. So it's actually $100 per manager, not per town. Okay.
That's correct.
So we better not get any more managers because they're very expensive. That's a joke, Fred. Don't take offense.
Okay. Any further? Because I have a couple of comments. Go ahead, Brian. You first.
I just have one comment.
Yes.
When I was working for a corporation, just because someone above me made less than I did when I was an hourly worker, I don't think that's a good road to go down. I believe you earn what you earn, and based upon previous raises and et cetera. But I don't think to just the fact to the town manager, you should be paid the most. I just don't see that logic.
Okay.
But that's my only comment.
Okay. All set? Because I'd rather have you speak up first. Okay. I'm going to... I do not support this section of the budget. The town manager and the assistant manager will be making a combined salary of $204,150. That includes the motor vehicle allowance and $4,500 for training for the assistant manager. It does not include benefits. In 2014, on November 1st, the assistant manager was hired with no experience. The personnel policy was ignored. There was no competitive advertising, no resumes, and no other applicants. I went to the past 2 years, 2015 and 2016. The salaries for both positions are up to, by a figure of $22,000. The Board of Selectmen meetings this fall, manager has been present, and in his report, he has again identified a problem in the Department of Public Works. Mr. Welch said the DPW is using all of its resources to pick up trash. Director Jacobs said the town does not have a highway department in the summer. Chairman Bridle said the town has grown. There are new streets and new businesses, and there is some talk of adding three more employees. That's been floated by a couple of times. Selectman Waddell said, why should DPW solely deal with trash? He also said solid waste pickup is overwhelming the town. The problem has been identified, but where is the solution? Management's job is to provide solutions, options, remedies, plans in problem situations. The Board of Selectmen should be demanding action, including interacting with one source of the problem, which is the Planning Board. And if any of you noticed the Planning Board meeting the other night when Mr. Kelly is looking to have his the plan changed so he can put trash out. We have this year proposed a $5.2 million operating budget for the Public Works Department. It's the largest department, actually takes up about one-fifth of our annual budget. We just paid off a $3.1 million debt for the Public Works Department, which included the three mechanical packers, six trailers, which are being beaten to death, and the first shipment of the carts. The DPW director and his deputy, I think, are overwhelmed at this point in time. They've got the pipes to the wastewater treatment plant, engineers to work with, the seawall is collapsing, the dog poop in the drains, and federal mandates. The transfer station is aging, and the foundation may be starting to give way. That was built in 96 and probably wasn't built terribly well. Their ability to run and manage that department is being crippled by trash. We are also carrying about $6 million in rolling stock and accessories in the Public Works Department. The director and deputy cannot do their job as they envision it under the current circumstances. For the first time after 30 years of lack of management in that department, we have two professionals who can modernize and restore and reconstruct if they have a board of selectmen and managers who allow them to accomplish their goals. What I see here is Hampton's version of Groundhog Day. And for those of you who didn't see the movie, It was a day that was repeated over and over and over and over again. And unless the matter of trash is resolved, Hampton is going to be trapped again in Groundhog Day. Remember also that there's a significant possibility that the Board of Selectmen can give out more non-union raises, including the two managers, once the budget is approved by the public on March 14th. So starting on March 15th, there could be another round of non-union raises. Remember that we are, as long as we're trapped in the time lapse here, the director and the deputy will still be crippled in their ability to lead this department, and the taxpayers do not deserve this. So I am not going to support, nor am I going to vote to approve this section of the operating budget. If you're ready for the vote, I will ask for those in favor of the town manager budget. And would you repeat the figure?
288-487.
288-487. In favor?
Why do I have 282?
I remember you got the revised pages. The OBS, the 1220 pages.
I thought we were not using those.
Well, we shouldn't be using those because the...
That section didn't change on the...
Yeah, I was going to say.
Looking in the book, it's under. Look under Board of Selectmen, Tim. You're looking under administration.
Yes.
That section didn't change, though, from 1120 to 1220.
Your book should be okay.
No, what I was doing was looking at the default column. My apologies.
Okay. So
I do that sometimes.
I need to see hands again because we got sidetracked. In favor of approving that section of the operating budget. Barnes, Bridle, Kravitz, Lapham, Augustine, LaBranch, and Ladd. Opposed? Pierce, Henderson, Woolsey, Pluff, Maurer, Jones. I lost count, but I think the yeas had it.
Got a tally on it,
Barbara? Barbara will tell us.
Hold on one second. Yep. The noes are Mr. Pierce, Mr. Henderson, Ms. Woolsey, Mr. Pluff, Mr. Jones, and
Maurer. Dave Maurer.
That would be 7 in the affirmative and 6 in the negative.
7 affirmative and 6 negative. Great. Thank you very much, Barbara. All righty, proceeding.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion for the legal budget for $176,182.
Second.
All right. And discussions, discussion, if any, what is your pleasure? Here it is. Right tab. Are you ready to tell them? Repeat that one more time for me, Steve.
176-182.
Okay. Discussion?
You know, this is an interesting little problem, Madam Chair.
Yes.
For those who are not aware, the Board of Selectmen had a meeting tonight, or 4 o'clock this afternoon. After coming out of non-public, they made their position clear that they were not going to pay for the Budget Committee's hired attorney. Am I stating that accurately, Regina?
That's correct.
Okay. And so it does pose the question, should the Budget Committee pay for the Selectman's attorney?
Well, no, that's not correct.
We actually have the attorney here, too, and it's his budget, so I think he should be...
Well, you actually had Budget Committee members at the Selectman's meeting, and you didn't invite them to speak at the time you were making a decision not to pay for the Budget Committee's attorney. So I see no reason to ask the Selectman's attorney to come here to ask the Budget Committee whether we want to pay for the Selectman's attorney.
As far as I know, he's not the Selectman's attorney.
He is, in fact,
as well.
Entirely by the Board of Selectmen.
He's the
town council for the whole town and the whole town budget.
That's the way it should be, but it isn't. He works directly for the selectmen. He's paid by the selectmen.
There's a conflict, Jenny. The selectmen's interest prevails.
He's paid by the selectmen. He's paid by the town. We're talking about the town budget right now.
So isn't the budget committee's, so isn't the line item for the budget committee's lawyer paid by the town?
And we have town council and we have NHMA, who you don't like anymore either.
No, no. Who we don't have access to anymore, thanks to the Board of Selectmen.
Well, if you want to hire an attorney, you go to the proper channels.
Well, that's what we were trying to do, but no, we just got rejected out of hand.
No.
Wait.
There is proper procedure.
Hold on for a minute. We voted in public after receiving notice from Attorney Gerald. We took a public vote at our December 20th meeting. That is documented, and the wording is all set in the minutes.
But
if someone, excuse me, if someone had a problem with that, they could have picked up the telephone and said, hey, you guys can't do that because we control the money and we're not going to sign anything, and we let's sit down and work this out. But that was not done. I have had the same phone number in this community for 53 years, and every darn one of you knows how to find me. And if somebody had a problem with that public vote, they could have picked up the phone and contacted me.
Public vote to decide for the budget committee to get an attorney?
Yes.
But in order for anyone to get...
We gave you the signed document.
Yes, but in order for anyone to get an attorney, it has to be signed by Fred. And in order for it to be signed by Fred...
We could have had someone pick up the confounded phone and said, hi, folks, you took a vote, but there are things you have to do. So, nobody contacted me.
So what
can
the problem
is? Can you help me out as far as the typical procedure for all other boards
and committees?
We don't
do this all the time, and we're not all other boards. This is the first time I can...
No, I don't think we need that, Regina.
The rules are the same for all the boards.
No, they're not, actually. No,
as far as hiring,
The Board of Selectmen are exempted.
Yeah. As far as hiring,
the Board of Selectmen are exempted from their own rules.
Where are the rules?
Yes, only Mr. Welch can sign a contract.
Yes, but we didn't even get to that.
I know,
but what I'm saying?
This is where we need to go to the future, because Monday. Well, I don't know. It's probably too late now to get on the agenda for Monday. But it was not rejected. It was just that you just need to go before the selectmen.
That's fine. If someone picked up the telephone subsequent to December 20th.
Well, this is what we're trying to explain now.
It's holidays.
I don't get it.
It's been a...
Madam Chair, point of order.
But I made a motion for a budget.
Yes.
I think we're straying far away from...
Well, I think...
Approving this motion that's on the floor. I think we're... Very far away from
we're doing discussion.
Excuse me. After you made your motion, I made a statement that as a consequence of this recent activity, I am less inclined to vote for the selectman's attorney, given the selectman's lack of support for the budget committee having an attorney. That's all I said, okay, essentially.
And I would like to say it's not the selectman's attorney, it's the town council.
Other people are commenting on.
Thank you.
You can call him God's counsel if you want to. The fact of the matter is, his client is the Board of Selectmen. The Board of Selectmen direct his activities exclusively, at least allegedly.
Well, if we follow the procedure...
But where is the procedure, Brian?
Well, this is what was explained.
I was about to agree with Regina's statement regarding procedure and
they
Brian.
They can pick up the phone.
I guess you could have called them, too.
Why did I call them? We did the motion in...
Yes.
We did the motion in public. We discussed it in public.
I understand
I'm
that,
a little confused.
I didn't realize.
It is not being realized.
I defer to Attorney General.
I would like to make a point real quick.
I don't deal with
I'm
attorneys.
A little confused. If the selectman can use a town attorney to blast us out of the water with a cannonball, why can't we get a lawyer without going through the selectman? Because naturally, if they don't like us or are trying to destroy us, why would we need their approval? Because they would automatically say no. So it doesn't make any sense to me that the budget committee needs anybody's approval to do anything.
To follow on that, I've asked for the past 3 weeks to various people, if the town attorney represents the selectman, and he's a town attorney, doesn't he also represent everybody in the town, including the budget committee? And I've been told no.
Right.
That confuses me, because if he's the town attorney, he should represent me as a member, in my opinion, and maybe he can clarify this for me, please.
Conflict of interest.
Well, conflict of interest, he's also my attorney.
But he's not, that's the problem.
Right?
He's not.
No. It comes down to one versus the other. He is
He's the selectman.
He's obligated to the selectman.
Right.
Okay, that answers
the question. And then all we need to do is, if we're going to still get an attorney...
Now, wait a minute. Let me finish what I started to say, because you're interrupting in the sense that I said that he, if he weren't going to do this, he could also represent the budget committee on other things. And I've been told no. So what you just said doesn't necessarily work. It's saying he really is, and I'd like to have it clarified. That's all. Is he just the selectman's attorney, or if I went to him on the sake of our marriage, or we went to him, whatever, and we have a problem, isn't he also our? And we also have a line man we went over before.
He's right there. Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Ask him.
Right. Yeah.
Ask him. I will.
I only took pre-law, so I can't help you there.
But also, don't we also have a thing? Last week we went over it, we had like $2,000 in a line item for legal fees. Wouldn't that help with the town? Now, the town attorney, could you please help me?
Okay.
There.
I do advise regularly many boards in town. Questions that come to me through the chairman of the board, so I don't take them one board member at a time. So if the board needs to ask me questions, I would answer them, unless there is some conflict with the subject.
We took that step after we received your letter on 91A. Obviously, you were acting in behalf of the Board of Selectmen.
I took the selectmen's direction to send to each board member individually a right to know law request.
Yes.
And you were representing the selectmen at that point in time,
right?
I took their direction to do that.
I recall when I read the minutes on December 5th, Board of Selectmen, Mr. Waddell suggested a letter to the Budget Committee. You didn't send a letter, you sent an RSA 91 request. See there's a line here for outside counsel. Planning board, I guess it was last year, disagreed with your ruling. They went through an outside counsel.
Planning board, I think you're talking about a question there as to obligation for lighting. And they wanted to have an answer from someone other than myself.
Mm-hmm.
They went to the selectmen, they asked them, can we hire this outside counsel?
They went to the
selectmen said yes.
Yeah.
But Mark,
there's a line here for $35,000.
The budget committee has not had a legal line until this past year. And we received the letter that you sent in behalf of the Board of Selectmen and felt that we wanted counsel. If we did not have the right to do that, we did the best we could under the circumstances that we had, and it was holiday time to boot, someone could have picked up the phone and called us and said, by the way, you know, you guys took that vote, but you need to be aware that you'll need to run this by the Board of Selectmen and the manager, etc. The Budget Committee is an independent elected committee, so I think that we were within our rights to seek counsel. It wouldn't hurt if people communicated a little better around here. Well,
it's something you've been on the Board of Selectmen. You've seen that very instance with the planning board when they came for that. That's been the procedure all along. The selectmen approve the hiring of outside counsel.
Well, if we need to go in, then we will go in and make an appointment or however we need to do it.
Sure.
One clarifying point on what you said, Mark, that questions to you from the boards go through the chairman. I heard that right.
Correct? Individual questions such as, do we advise? I don't take it from 15 different people asking me questions.
Right.
Those get funneled through the chairman.
Yeah.
Right, and that'd be true for all of the boards.
True.
Yeah.
And this committee, which is not a board, but a committee.
Sure.
Except one. There's one exception, isn't there? The Board of Selectmen is exempt from that. Individual selectmen ask you questions all the time, right?
Yes. Yes,
true.
They do.
So once again, the Board of Selectmen is exempt from the Board of Selectmen's policy on that. Just wanted to point that out.
Okay.
I got one other question for Mark. Isn't it true in the past you've recused yourself, or whatever the right word is, when there's a conflict between boards in Hampton?
At times. So, I don't view a right to know law request for information that the law requires people to produce as necessarily a conflict situation.
Well, let me ask you this question. Why are you asking for the 91A then?
Because it had come to my attention and the selectmen's attention that there had been communications by email outside of a public meeting from various members to all of the board, which was not purely informational. It was expressing opinions, offering information that would be used to influence decisions. And those are things that come up at these meetings in public, in front of the public, and not somewhere on the side. And as a result, I sent an email to all of you that said, these types of emails violate the right to know law, and in particular, a recent Superior Court case in which the town of Sandwich got whacked.
And that's being appealed.
It is being appealed, but it's still a case that everyone needs to know about, and municipal attorneys in the groups that get together train their clients in accordance with that decision, which is what I did last year, not only to this board, but to the planning board, the Zoning Board of Adjustment, the trustees of the trust funds, the Energy Committee. You know, these are the types of things, if you know that that's a potential out there, you don't want to take the chance of risking hundreds of thousands of dollars of attorney's fees, because you never know who's going to take issue with that type of proceeding.
I appreciate that, but in that particular case, the judge ruled that it was an opportunity for people to respond. And that would be true if I sent out an email to everyone on the budget committee that we're going to have a meeting next week as a procedural thing. And there's an opportunity to respond to that, too. So what I'm trying to say is the judge's ruling is borderline ridiculous, okay? And I think you can appreciate that looking at it from that point of view. So I think that you standing on that is very inappropriate, in my opinion.
Well, the emails that caught my attention in the attention of the selectmen were the emails that were more than just minutes from the secretary that said, here are your minutes. They were more than saying, okay, we have a meeting this coming date. They were more than that.
So you're saying that there was emails sent to everybody on the budget committee that took a position on something and encouraged somebody else to do the same thing?
Or expressed an opinion that something that would occur in this meeting.
You sent your emails in Marin?
Yeah.
Okay. Tim, you had a question?
I think everybody's got the same emails here.
Right.
Yes.
What did you find in Bob's that...
Well, I haven't gotten all the responses yet to know. Let's see what the requests show.
Well, you know,
I would like to have that question.
Yeah, wait one second for me. I sent emails to everyone so everyone would know what was going on. Nobody responded to me because I sent emails that said, I have corrected the schedule for the fifth time or the eighth time or whatever it was.
There was more than that.
Well,
there was
I don't remember
there
that.
There was a response to one
yes,
of your emails.
Mr. Pierce and Ms. Barnes got into this conversation a couple of meetings ago. Mr. Pierce was asking for evidence of this nature. Ms. Barnes responded with a forwarding of the email the next day.
And provided a hard copy.
Right, well, anyway, Mr. Pierce shared that response with me. And so I am now knowledgeable as to the genesis, as Mr. Bean would call it, as to this entire action. Right? This was that email.
There were several emails.
It was that email that was the genesis of this action.
Not necessarily. There were a number of emails.
Oh, well, that was what Regina was representing to Mr. Pierce.
So,
just because Mr. Pierce said that, but no one replies, that's why I brought that specific one up.
Yeah.
And that, oh, so that wasn't the entire genesis. Okay, fine.
There was a Porter,
I haven't asked the question.
Porter versus Sandwich case, Mark, that I'm citing to you said in particular, it doesn't matter if anyone responds.
Mark.
The emails create an opportunity.
Exactly. And that, if I sent out an email telling me that we're going to have a meeting next week, that'd be violating that judge's ruling. And that is purely ridiculous. You know, how can you communicate to your fellow members?
I'm not finished yet.
Oh, all right. Okay. Go ahead.
Back to your statement on policy of answering questions through the chair. When individual members receive correspondence from you, we receive that as individual members, correct?
That depends.
Well, in this case, you sent us individual communication.
I
addressed to us individually.
As counsel, I copied all of you.
But those letters were sent to us individually, as individual members, correct?
You were copied as counsel, giving advice.
No. I'm talking about the 91A request that you sent to us each individually.
Correct.
Okay. So you did not send it to the budget committee. You sent it to budget committee members individually.
Well, I didn't send it to you because you weren't a member of the budget committee. I sent it to you because you are.
Well, let's stay with the positive rather than the negative.
Yep.
You sent it to the individual members, not to the budget committee as a whole. You did not communicate to us through the chair. So you communicated to us individually.
Right.
So if we individually responded to you by, say, a phone call saying, hey, Mark, I'd like to get clarification on this, give me a call back, and we get no phone call back, okay, then we can, I think, reasonably conclude that you're not going to, you know, help in any way in terms of getting clarity and just exactly what you're asking for, and that this may be an adversarial situation in which we should take extra care. And so I think that to be reasonable, don't you think so, Mark? I mean, if you had a client in that situation, wouldn't you so advise him to take extra care if they wouldn't even call you back and say, yeah, I can give you some clarity. What do you need?
The letter that I sent out requested that all responses be made to the selectman's office.
Yeah, but that's exactly the point. It was not clear exactly to me exactly what was being requested. And it still is to this day not clear to me exactly what's being, but we're not going to get into that tonight.
I haven't heard that through anyone.
Well, you're hearing it right now on TV, and you can watch it 1,000 times if you want to. It is not clear what you're asking for. Okay? And when a member calls you up because you sent him an individual letter asking for information, and a member calls you up and says, hey, can I get some clarity? And he gets no call back. What's the member to do?
I've received no such calls.
Take a big guess as to what he's asking for and maybe violate the right to know law? Or does he go see counsel and say, hey, counsel, help me out. I want to do this right. I don't want to violate the law. That seems to me to be the most reasonable course that any reasonable person would take.
I've received no such call.
That's untrue.
Yeah.
And I think it's pretty simple because I'm reading the request. And this request seeks records and information from all members of the Budget Committee requesting copies of any and all written correspondence, including but not limited to emails, etc., etc., amongst the Budget Committees. I get it.
Well, and you may get it, but I don't. Mark, have you gotten anyone that has fully satisfied that request?
Yes.
Yeah.
So how many years should they go back?
That's a yes, as far as I know.
Okay, so they all sent you printed copies of everything.
No, they sent it to the selectman's office.
No. Well, the instructions in the letter was to send it to 100 Winneconnet Road, okay? Now, the only way to do that is via paper.
Yeah.
So you got everyone printed out all their emails, they gave you copies of all their budget books, all the handouts that they've gotten through all the years they served on the Budget Committee, Mark. Because your request includes everything from all time, all communications, and the phrase others, I might add,
and
Ryan,
others.
Also includes others. Any email or love notes that we may have received from any of our constituents. or any response that I have may have given my nephew who lives in Alaska asking me, how's things going on the budget committee, Uncle Tim? And I responded to him and told him, and I'm supposed to tell you about that too, because you're asking for all of that. So when I say it's not clear, I consider it overly burdensome if you take it literally for the way it's written.
Right.
And I don't think he meant it literally. And so, therefore, I consider it unclear.
Well, I'm
so I want to be clear on why it's not clear to me, Brian.
I did not respond to him in telling Mrs. Woosley how my wife was doing in surgery.
That's because you choose to interpret it that way, but that's not what literally he asked for. And when you're dealing with legal matters, you deal with it literally.
Let me put it this way, folks. I think I have an obligation as the chairman of this committee to let everybody know what's going on at the same time. If I have to change a schedule, and it's been mostly schedule and meeting date changes, I send out a copy to everybody. Regina is a member of the committee. She gets a copy. Bob Ladd gets a copy. Whoever. And I'm. What do you want me to do? Send individual emails? If I'm sending individual emails, I'm having a problem. Am I supposed to call 12 people?
Same problem.
And tell them, same problem, because then I'm talking to them personally. I have sent no written correspondence to anybody. Regina has copies. I've made a couple of requests to Fred or Christy by themselves, or just Fred and Christy's name on them. But you know, aside from the one email when I really got blasted by people that weekend, and I said, boy, everybody jumped all over me because they're all mad over the money, and I probably shouldn't have sent that, but I was so dazzled having everybody yell at me all weekend that I thought I would share that thought. Other than that, I just am sending routine informational emails out.
Did you do the training with the board about emails?
Mm-hmm.
Last year, yes.
We also
did you do it this year with the new members or new board?
No, the NHMA people came in, and as I understand it, they talked about the same thing with emails.
Right, but I think it might be just a suggestion that maybe every year we need to go over this because it's really tricky.
Mark, when the NHMA was in, when Buckley and Burns were in, they ordered Channel 22 shut off. Do you remember when you got upset with the zoning board when they were fighting and Channel 22 got turned off? And that set you on an email, an RSA 91A crusade. NHMA told us to turn off those cameras. And they were turned off, and there were no legal issues discussed while the cameras were off. And Mr. Jones, Mr. Pierce, and I objected, and that's on the tape. That's on the tape. And they said that they only represent the Board of Selectmen. This is messy.
Another point I'd like to make is the reason why so many things were copied, like the request through Regina, was so everybody on the committee would know we, in fact, had asked for something like a half a dozen times for each article.
Yeah.
Each item. Getting information back to from the selectmen or whomever in the town has been impossible this year. It's been the worst I've ever seen it. Period.
Well, sometimes you can't just get what you want right when you want it.
You have to at least respond like you might think about doing it this year.
Oh my God. I'm
done. No, but Regina, I sent an email to you that said, I'm following up because there has been a unanimous vote of the budget committee to please give us the IT report.
We did. Once we got it, when did this come in? And we approved it tonight, and right after we approved it tonight.
We haven't seen the confounded blankety-blank IT report until you handed it to us this evening.
We just saw it tonight for the first time. Brian and Tim were there.
You voted it?
Yeah, yes.
Tonight. Well, big deal. But the vote was, what, in October or something?
We didn't have it.
I know, but you could respond and say, hey, we haven't got it yet.
Kim's asked me several times about it, and that's what I've told him.
Well,
I was asked for
Madam Chair, exactly what are we discussing?
I don't know.
We're discussing the legal account.
There's a confusion.
For 187, whatever it is.
Thank
that's
you,
what
Jenny.
It's supposed to be.
Thank you, Jenny.
If the procedure dictates that I go in to see the Board of Selectmen, normally they won't take appointments at this, you know, time, but if I am to call the town office tomorrow morning and see if I can get a spot on the agenda for Monday night, I will do that.
Would you like one?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. What time? Where on the agenda?
7:00
okay. On Monday.
All right. But I think this right really, and I really think, Mark, you could have come in and talked to us in public. Bad timing in the holiday time, and I think that budget committees are not generally, messed up like this. But I think we thought, and I certainly thought, that I was doing what I could to advise, to inform everyone. And I did ask for information from Regina, but I didn't ask anybody to tell me how they were going to vote, whatever. Give 1 second, let me do Steve, and then we'll do you.
Okay, for this committee, everyone that's here, including, I think, our newest member.
Dave, yeah.
Correct?
No, actually, entirely.
No, I came on in April.
Oh, that's right. You're right.
I came on in April.
Who has only been on this board for 6 weeks? Is that about right?
And I have had zero training on
okay.
It.
Okay.
But you haven't fun, right?
And I just want to mention to everybody here, especially to David, okay, that if you respond to an email that's been sent out to everybody here, that creates an illegal meeting. He's new, okay? He's very new. So I just want to acknowledge that he has had no training.
Yeah, there needs to be substance to the response, doesn't there, Mark? I mean, for example, I sent out a link.
And I think he learned his lesson. Wait, I was still talking.
I never got a response.
And I hope that if anybody did respond accidentally, just because perhaps they didn't know, that they know now what the deal is.
This is before David, but I remember either Mary Louise, maybe it was Nick, but I'm pretty sure it was you, saying in one of these meetings, do not reply at all for that specific purpose. Yeah. So I think we were trying to avoid any sort of...
How many of you emailed me back when I said this is my ninth correction?
I specifically remember that, and that's why I've never replied.
That's right. Exactly. You're exactly correct. Dave was new. Dave's the one that replied to it.
Yeah.
And I don't consider Dave's reply to be substantial. I mean, I sent out a link to everyone tonight, all right, so they could listen to the audio of tonight's selectmen's meeting.
Yes.
Okay? Now, if someone replies to that and says, thank you, would you consider that a violation of the right to know law?
I'm not going to get into
hypotheticals. Exactly, you wouldn't, because there's no substance to it.
No, I've said I'm not going to get into hypotheticals tonight.
Oh, well, will someone do that now? Send me a thank you so it won't be hypothetical any longer. So all Dave said was to Mary Louise was, good to hear. No, I'm happy. Nor am I happy about them. That's not substantive in my mind.
It's an opinion.
I think the judge would share that opinion.
We are not comporting ourselves tonight in a way that the people watching this are going to be proud of. We've got to get back to budget and off this yin and yang between the two groups.
But we've been placed in a difficult situation, Bob, and it's either nobody knows what's going on at all, and 95% of that is scheduling and what to do and where to show up and all that. I don't think I've ever gotten a response from any one of the emails I sent to you guys saying, attention, you know, throw the old one away, here's the new. It's been mostly scheduling. But anyway, we do need to clarify.
Yeah, I'll tell you this,
but I will show up on Monday.
I'll tell you this, Mary Louise.
Yes.
In my business career, I have had a number of attorneys, well over a dozen. And never once did one attorney that was representing me or companies that I was working with ever say to me, I don't entertain hypotheticals. Now, I've had attorneys who were not representing my company would say that to me, but never one that was actually representing me. So I think that's just another indicator as to whether or not he's representing you, David, as you were asking.
But I think a phone call might have avoided a lot of this stuff, frankly.
On a phone call on either side. You could have called Mary Louise, Mark could have called. Okay, 6-1, half dozen the other. We really need to get back to the legal accountant and the approval of that part of money.
Brian, real quick, and then we're going to get focused in.
No, I'm not going down there. they show on your 12-14 report, amount available, $10,477 for the legal.
The financials for November?
Yes. No, December.
December
14.
December financials are not done.
I have December
14, 2016. That's through 11:30, correct? I don't have those with me, but I believe that's the financials from November.
Oh, okay. Well, I was just curious. Are we going?
I have not released December yet, because they're not done.
Right.
All right. Well. Thank you anyway.
I think you'll see the document says through November 30, although it was sent out in December.
As they always
do. Oh, really?
So it's an 11
month. Are we going to come in under budget? Yeah. That's what I'm assuming.
Under budget for legal?
Yes.
They are getting close.
Okay. That's where I was getting. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Move on, Madam Chair.
Yes. And I will, yes, and I will make one more comment. You never replied to me. You never responded to me. You never called me, Mark, when I stuck my head in your door and said, please notify the NHMA that I am chairing now. Nick is gone as of September. And I didn't stand there browbeating you. I just made a request. And after that, the board voted on December 5th to chop everybody off except for the top five. So I'm a little bit concerned. Okay. In favor of the bottom line of the operating budget for legal. Repeat that again. I have 176182.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. In favor? Okay. We have Barnes, Bridle, Kravitz, and Brian. Fluff, and Augustine, and Ranch, and Ladd. Opposed? Pierce, Henderson, Woolsey, Jones, and Maurer. All right.
Thank you.
We
Madam Chair, I'd like
thank you,
to
Town
thank you very much.
Could I just make sure of the nose, please?
Nose were Pierce and Henderson, Woolsey. No. And
I have Jones
and Mara.
Henderson, Woolsey, and Pierce.
Yes.
And Jones.
Anybody
and
Mara. Else is a no? Mara?
Yeah, Mara.
Anybody else is a yes.
Okay.
Next, Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion.
Wait 1 second. Smile at me because I've got to pull out among the 3,989.
What's the next one?
Personnel Administration.
Oh, that's Christy. Okay, good.
Are you ready for the motion, Madam Chair?
I'm trying to find the page. Give me 1 second.
OBS 5.
Okay, Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion for the Personnel Administration budget to recommend $3,179,510.
Second.
Okay. And seconded by Mr. Lapham. Okay. All righty. There's a new publication out that's talking about the New Hampshire retirement system, and it looks like it's in substantial trouble. Are you guys getting any updates, any status reports, anything at all on the retirement system? Nothing? They're just running around up there in Concord messing up. Okay. Any questions for Christy on the personnel?
don't have any questions for Christy, I don't think, but I do have some observations.
Okay.
The famous merit pay, remember that, Jenny?
I do.
It's still there, and it still seems to be functioning as it did 4 years ago in your last little question. But even a little bit more of a twist there. As you can see, in 2016, we had a budget of $15,595. We spent $18,427. And now they're requesting $28,891. Yet, from all indication, the raises that were given out in 2016 far exceed the actuals reported here of only $18,427. Now, Jenny, in the SAU 90, SAU 90 has a merit pay line.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And from what I understand, its purpose, which was actually the original purpose of this line when it was created several years ago, was to give out bonuses to people who do extraordinary work during the course of the year.
One year only, one time.
Yeah. One time only based on an evaluation.
Right.
Yes.
But that's not how this is being used ever. As you know, from 4 years ago, we talked about it.
Correct.
There was, as usual, some sort of flat percentage given to everybody, or rephrase that, given to every non-union person, as though they all deserved equal merit, which is astounding that such a group of people could all be equal in terms of merit, being meritorious in their service. But the real concern here is that we've got a budget number that seems to be completely irrelevant to the reality that the staff experienced year after year after year. You can see that point, can't you?
I can see that it's your point, yes.
You can see that reality, can't you?
Yeah, I can see what?
Mr. Pierce, you ran some numbers. Regina responded to your numbers, okay? And whether you talk about Regina's numbers or your numbers, you're talking numbers that are far in excess of $18,427.
Yes, and Christy actually broke everything out for you that I passed out, I believe, a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And if you want to talk wages, then...
And that's my point. The raises far exceed the budgeted $18,427.
It may be a situation where the school district is handling this in a much more sensible fashion.
I would say the school board is handling it as the school board and the superintendent agreed to handle it.
Right.
The town is handling it in the way that the board of selectmen and the town manager agreed to handle it.
Right. When the board of selectmen created this line item, though, they created it on the same basis that the SAU 90 created it, and that was for bonus pay.
Yeah, because merit pay should be.
But it's never actually been handled that way.
Right.
And now it seems to be blown way out of proportion in terms of the actual numbers given out versus what the budget.
I don't know how they do that, but that's okay.
It's okay if you don't know.
So what we did was we put 2% in for everyone non-union and 3% or 6% for three positions to be transparent. It's in the detail section of the merit raises.
Right.
It doesn't mean that it's actually going to get given to them. But instead of having to figure it out next year, we already have the number there for everyone to see.
Well, I'm not talking about 2017 right now. I was actually focusing on 2016. Budgeted versus the actual experience.
2016.
Even the actual numbers that are reported here are, you know, pale in comparison by what was actually spent in terms of raises.
And in addition, instead of being a one-time reward, which you may or may not get in a given year, this is an automatic pasted onto your salary, and so it continues ad infinitum. And that's a little different concept.
And it doesn't include, you know, the benefits that go along with that. I mean, we give a person a dollar raise. How much does that actually cost us for $1.40?
We give them a dollar. Depends on what union they're in and whether they pay into Social Security or not.
$1.40 wouldn't be an inaccurate number to throw out there, right?
Yep. We're not talking unions.
We give someone a dollar raise, it's going to cost the town $1.40 right. to pay them.
But we're not talking unions here. We're talking, the collective bargaining is totally different. We're talking about...
Well, you've got FICA, you got health,
well,
you know,
some
insurance,
non-union
retirement.
Are in the police retirement, and some non-union are in the fire right. retirement, right. and some non-union are in right. the municipal retirement, and those rates range from 11.38
to 29.43 for police and 31.89 for fire. So they're drastically different depending on what where the employee falls. If you're looking at the employer costs. Christy, what yeah. we're trying to say is, as opposed to a one-time bonus check, if you will, a merit check, whatever you want to call it, you happen to get it this year because you did a great job. But it doesn't keep carrying forward and forward and forward.
I was answering
yourself.
His question about the dollar being $1.40.
Okay.
That was the only question I was
answering. Well, I mean, you know, we talked about this 4 years ago, Jenny. Yep. You remember, right?
Yep.
We had a good time with that
yep.
conversation.
We did.
How good was
things
it?
Did not get, things did not get contentious or adversarial. We were just exploring
That's
it. And we agreed that we needed more clarity on how this was actually being used. Mm-hmm. And we still, in my opinion, don't have any additional clarity since then. I know lots of stuff goes on, things get slipped through the cracks and stuff like that. But the truth is, as far as I can see, if you give someone a dollar raise, you're going to pay, it's going to be costing you much more than a dollar. Right? $1.40, $1.50, $1.30, whatever. It's going to cost a lot more than a dollar to give someone a dollar raise.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not calculated in here, apparently. In fact, this line out tonight, it seems so fictitious, it seems absurd. How much do we give out in raises this year, Mike? You got it, Regina?
Above the union contract, probably a couple hundred thousand.
A couple hundred thousand.
Give or take.
Yeah, and yet we budgeted.
$282,000
was
the...
That includes
net
income. This is total wages. Yeah, that's total. They said
non-including
units.
I'm talking about salary and... wages and benefits, as was in my thing, which makes my numbers correct. 685-ish is what I come up with using your numbers, okay, for the total increase on wages and benefits. And you indicated it was only 450, which is about right if you look at only wages. So it's about 200,000, give or take. And benefits, with benefits. You can't give somebody a raise without them getting a benefit. It just goes with it. You already decided that.
The particular point I was trying to drive to is that we gave 200 something thousand dollars in raises last year. That seems to be a consensus, right? And yet we only budgeted $15,595.
$35,000.
And so, next year we're budgeting, our requested budget is $28,800. And we're going to do the same thing next year that we did this year. And that number should be like $289,000, not $28,900.
You couldn't have got paid $289,000.
It was about $35,000 or $38,000,
yeah.
I think. It went over.
Well, I thought I heard Regina just say that the raises...
That's total wages.
Total
including
wages.
Including total wages. Wages. And $145,000 of that was approved last year's town meeting.
I'm only asking how much were raises given out.
Total wages,
this year,
net increase $282,000.
Non-union, you say non-union? Well, I'm just trying to...
I don't have the... This is total union and non-union.
Yeah. So we have no data to base this particular random number on.
After all the conversations we've had, we still don't have a number.
Yeah.
November financial report, what was the line total for merit pay?
I think it was 38,000 somewhere
18,427?
Well, maybe the 28. It might be the 28.90.
That was in November. It was 18.4.
And the raises were all done by then.
Yeah, that's the actual that was applied to this line.
It was like 10,000.
But I know there was more than that. I mean, the police chief himself, all by himself, had a $10,000 raise.
Well, that's what...
And then he had 2% across the board for non-union. I mean, this had to be well over 18,000.
Right.
Then my question would be, where did that come from?
That's... There you go, Jenny. There you go.
It came from the police bottom. You don't approve. You approve a bottom line budget. What the town does with it is up to them.
So why are we talking? I understand that they can move things around according to law.
They can.
No problem with that.
Yep.
But we're looking at this budget book. We're saying, okay, that's what we're looking for raises for next year. And I'm like, well, based on what we did in 2016, that doesn't look any more realistic than it did in 2016.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
I have an amendment and a motion.
All righty.
To reduce the merit pay by $10,000.
Okay, is there a second? Mr. Maurer?
I'd like to
more in line to what we actually spent.
Okay.
I'd like to discuss that for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
As we just
gotta be able to hear you, Mike.
As we just got done pointing out, the merit line all by itself doesn't mean much. They can spend basically whatever they want. So what's the point of reducing it?
Because
what's
it takes it out of the budget.
Right. I would just say, I'll get rid of it. But other than that, I would just leave it alone. It's academic.
It makes it more in line to what we've spent in the past.
No, actually, it makes it less in line, because we spent considerably more in 2016 than that.
Well, I'm just going by this one line item.
Right. Me too.
Okay, well, Brian's intent.
I mean, what Mr. Pierce said makes perfect sense to me. It's like, well, this line is totally nonsensical in terms of there being any reflection of what we're actually going to be spending relative to merit pay.
No,
I don't have a problem with merit pay in itself conceptually either. The problem is this line does not reflect reality at all. Just there's no reflection of reality here at all. We might as well not even have the line at all. Take the 28,891 and put it under miscellaneous whatever they can't spend it on.
They're trying to make it have reality now. That's why it's a lot higher than it's been in the past.
Try that again?
Yeah, it's up 85%. I acknowledge that. Yeah.
Right, because we've already placed money there so that we're not going over budget on that line item. You know what I'm saying?
Regina, could the selectmen consider doing what the school board does and make merit raises literally merit raises? That way it wouldn't be...
Bonuses.
Hmm?
You mean bonuses.
Bonuses,
yeah.
Performance reunification, yeah, something that would not be continuing year after year once it's given out, and something that wouldn't inflate the annual salary, something that you might at least want to consider discussing. That way, outstanding people, as Fred pointed out, that everyone is given an assessment. You go and you check everyone, and they have to, including the manager, they all have their paperwork done. So that should be a good basis. It might be a little more manageable.
I just want as accurate a number as I can.
Excuse me, Mr. Jones. Excuse me, Mr. Jones. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just want to point out that when I was a selectman, one of the things we considered with spreading around equally was... How do you compare some of the people that would be eligible for that to others because they don't do the same job?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can compare a teacher to a teacher, but you can't compare...
You don't compare, Michael.
Well,
you take a set rule of guidelines and professional goals, yeah. And you evaluate them on that.
I understand that, but it's still left up to a very objective thing or a subjective thing by the people who make these decisions. And when I was there... I'm working even with the town manager. Sometimes it's difficult to separate and compare each one of them when you're trying to come up with a percentage, because you had to come up with a percentage because there's only so much money, mm-hmm. Okay, that we tried to divvy up. And I thought that, in my opinion, the best way to do it was to do it evenly across the board, because everybody knows what everybody makes in this town, because it's all in annual report and all that sort of thing. In private industry, I can see keeping it secret. But here... It's not secret. Everybody knows what's going on.
Brian's motion?
Yes.
It's already been moved.
Can we vote on it then? Thank you for the clarification.
No problem, Mr. Webb.
I just want to make sure that everybody understands there's a reason for doing it all equally.
Okay. I think you understand the intent of the motion. In favor of Brian's amendment to the initial motion. In favor? Okay, Lapham, Woolsey, and Maurer. Opposed? Barnes, Bridle, Pierce, Kravitz, Pluff, Ladd, and LaBranche. Stating?
Augustine.
No? Oh, Augustine.
Sorry.
And then Mr. Henderson is abstaining. Abstaining.
And I have joined Danielle Armstrong.
What a team.
He's a no.
Are you a no? She's abstaining.
No, she's a no.
Oh, I'm sorry.
She's a no, sorry.
That's why we're together.
Okay, Mr. Henderson is the only abstention.
I'm sorry, can I just take the no's again, so?
Yeses are easier, they're only three.
Not really. No's are the key.
You want the no's again?
The no's, please.
No's.
No, the no's.
The no's or the yeses?
Wait a minute. Okay, you are the no's. We were the yeses, okay.
We're doing no's now?
Yes.
Consider my hand raised. Okay.
You want the hands up or not for the no's?
Well,
we
I think
can't
we
take have, a vote now.
With the no's on this side.
We can't even vote anymore.
We've been so crippled.
Come on now. Madam Chair, you please ask.
I lost. That's what it comes from.
Okay. All right. You're all set.
Can I just
yes, ma'am.
Make it up. Say that? Those are Mr. Ladd, Mr. Jones, Ms. Arnstein, Ms. Barnes, Ms. Bridal, Russell, and Mr. Pierce.
And what happened to Mr. LaBrasse?
Mr. Travis was a...
Are you a no?
I'm a no.
Yeah. You're a no?
Yes. That's why I'm wondering. We need a vote again.
All right. Stick your hands up again so poor Barbara
can
get everybody...
For the no's or the yeses?
No's opposed.
No's.
No's. That's you, Tim.
No's.
I agree.
Okay. We got Barnes, Bridal, Pierce, Kravitz. We've got Plouffe, Augustine, Jones, Ladd, and LaBrasse.
I'm lost.
Please just do it again.
Forgive me.
Do it again.
I'm looking
slowly.
Let me just read them out.
Okay.
And then anybody who I don't get right, tell me. Mr. Pierce, Ms. Bridal Russell, Ms. Barnes, Ms. Augustine, Mr. Jones, Mr. Ladd, and Mr. LaBrasse are no on the matter of the amendment.
And Mr. Kravitz.
No, you're as well.
No.
He's a no, and also Mr. Plouffe.
And Mr. Plouffe.
Okay.
All right.
So that should count up to nine.
And Mr. Henderson is the only abstention.
Well, nine, because Henderson's paying, right? Yeah. So, Madam Chair, the only reason I brought that up was that I'm constantly calling for more accuracy, and above all the lines in this budget, this one seems to be the least accurate of all.
Yeah.
And
can
at
we
this
move
point,
the next item?
No, because I'm talking.
You are always talking.
And you're always trying to move somewhere else. But go ahead, feel free.
You can't hear if people are talking.
So my point is that at this stage, we're not going to get an accurate number, quite apparently, even though we know this is woefully off whack with what we actually did in 2016. It just is. Everyone seems to agree on that. The question of degree, the actual number, all that, that may be argumentative, but the number that's reflected in here is got no reflected in reality with regard to what happened in 2016. And so it really lessens my confidence that this number, though up 85%, Regina, I acknowledge that, in an attempt to make it more accurate, is still going to be woefully inadequate, I suspect, next year as well. So I just can't buy this number. Right. Well, Mr. Lapham, the only reason I voted against your motion was because I think that would have made it even less accurate. And my striving here is to make it accurate, not simply to reduce or raise, but just simply make it accurate. So okay. That's all I'm going to say.
Okay, we're all set. Now, we're going to call up. Yes?
We need to take a vote on my motion, which is to recommend $3,179,000.
You're already in public works.
No, he's still in personnel.
We gotta see if you don't need to repeat it. Just call for the vote, Madam Chair.
Okay. In favor, Brian's was an amendment.
Yeah, it was amendment, right.
Okay.
Now it's for the budget.
So in favor of the total personnel admin budget. Figure again.
$3,179,510.
No, no, no.
Yes.
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 Yes,
it is.
Yes. Oh, that's right. It is because
yes.
of all
yes.
that.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Totally. All right. Barnes is in favor.
Jenny. Oh yes.
Bridal Russell.
God, there's no gas in here.
Kravitz, Henderson, Plouffe, Augustine, LaBrasse, and Ladd. Okay. Opposed. Pierce, Lapham, Woolsey, Jones, and Maurer. Abstaining?
I think we got everybody.
Okay.
Go ahead, Mr. Stephen Branch. Next.
Director Jacobs and ladies, Jen and Teresa.
Wait. Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion for the Financial Administration and MIS budget for 31. Let me see. I believe the subtotal.
Find MIS. Is running around here somewhere.
It should be on about OBS 4.
Is Jamie going to be here first for the MIS page?
OBS 4.
No.
All right.
On the old one. How about the new one?
I'm going to do this in pieces because it's in different parts of the book.
And which one are you
going to do? I'm going to do finance department first for $383,411.
Wait a minute.
There it is. Okay.
That's. Yeah. How much is that again?
383,411.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
On OBS 3. OBS 3.
We had an extensive conversation on this at previous meetings, I recall, on this particular budget.
No, I don't think we touched the finance.
Yeah, I got it all marked up. We did talk about it.
Well, I have it marked too, but that's because I was looking at stuff. Okay, questions on my left here? Anybody? Questions? Concerns? Finance?
Yeah, let's vote.
Okay, in favor of the finance bottom line, 383,411.
Unanimous.
Now you're going to MIS?
Yep.
No. I'm going to make a motion, Madam Chair, for
audit services
for $31,650.
Okay. Seconded by Mr. Pluff.
Yeah.
Okay, you understand the intent. In favor of the audit services line. Unanimous.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion for the MIS budget to recommend $210,779. Seconded by Mr. Henderson.
Questions on the management information systems account.
Yeah, we did this evening get the audit report. The IT audit report distributed. Mm-hmm. I consumed it prior to the meeting. I found it comforting. But how do I align that with our budget? And that I'm not clear on.
How much did it cost?
I know from the previous request that most of this was actually paid out of some IT line in the fire department, I believe. So that's what the cost of this was. And I understand also that it wasn't as complete as had been expected, so it was slightly paid. They were paid slightly less for it. Nonetheless, I consider this report to be a valuable report.
Oh, okay.
A report, you know, that you can actually work off of, work from. Okay? And I'm wondering if somebody in management can speak to whether you need more money to help pursue some of the elements that are discussed in this report, and how your existing budget aligns with this report.
Our existing budget does not align with the report because we did not get the report in the time frame that we had wanted to get the report. We started out to do this report so that we would have things to incorporate into either the MIS budget or into a warrant article. However, I will not swear to the date, but I believe we got this the week right before Christmas. So therefore, we did not get it in the time frame that was expected.
Right.
The first draft of the report that we did receive was not acceptable. Therefore, they came up with a new draft. So we have decided that we are going to work from this report so that next year's budget, we can come forward, budget or warrant article, depending on what it is we are looking for, we can come forward at that time, because then we will have time to have digested this, to meet with the IT employees, Jamie, myself, and them, and come up with a plan so that we're not just doing things in pieces so that we can have a plan going forward on what we want to do. So that's where we are at with that. Our intention when we started this process was to have it done this summer, because that's when they started this, in June, I believe.
Yeah.
And then that way we would have had time to incorporate things into either the budget or the warrant article. The only thing that we did do in the budget is break things down into more finite line items. You'll see that we have like computer support now and a couple of new line items so that you guys can more accurately see what's being paid for. So like computer support has like the licensing and stuff like that. That used to all just be thrown under supplies and expenses, so nobody knew what was being paid for. So I tried to break it down in more detail. We also, when we started this process, realized that we have very different users in this town. So we came up with three different categories of users for computers, and they each have different standards that computer needs to be built by. So that has been incorporated into the budget, so that when we are doing our replacement on PCs, I believe it's somewhere between 10 and 20 a year, depending on the year, we're replacing them with PCs that will better serve what they do. No, so that would be like only a little tiny piece that was incorporated into the budget that is in front of you.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff that we're trying to achieve was delayed a little bit by getting this report out. But as I said, this report is a useful document.
Yes.
And it's broad in scope in terms of the implementation that needs to occur.
Yes.
And it's, depending on how much of it management chooses to pursue in subsequent years, you're going to need considerable increase in money.
It's possible.
Likely, yeah. And to get into all of that detail in a budget committee is not a good thing.
Right.
So I'm hoping that I can get some encouragement that the IT subcommittee of the budget committee can be somewhere in play in the process, so that the budget committee can be more readily understanding of the increase that's likely to come. Because I expect, when I read this the first time tonight, prior to this meeting, much of it was actually coming out of other meetings, shall we say, over the years. The Selectman's IT committee from years ago, for example. Some of these bigger points were made previously. I very much endorse it. But again, it's a management decision as to how far and what timetable you want to implement it. But ultimately, you're going to have to need money. And I want the budget committee to be sufficiently informed so that we can just do this smoothly and get you what you need to get the job done right, because we can do far better. Paul and Dylan do a good job for what they do. The report's clear on that.
Yes.
But the truth is that the supporting environment is not sufficiently supporting, and it can be. And the whole town will benefit. The whole town government will benefit when it is. So I'm hoping to get some words of encouragement that you'll work with the IT subcommittee on the
budget. I believe that Mr. Sullivan has stated that he would like to sit down and have a meeting with you once we did have the report, so we could hear your ideas.
Excellent. Madam Chair, this budget is up a relatively small amount, 2.36%.
Yes.
And it's actually flat from last year. It was flattened out.
Yes.
So, I mean, it's fairly tight, and I don't think we need to do anything other than just vote yes on this. Okay?
Just one quick question.
Yes.
Fred, will this have any effect on what you're doing, trying to get those old records all scanned through or set up or memorialized?
Actually, no. Not at this time, no.
So that's not related?
No, not at this budget.
It's not under the MIS budget. No.
Not at all, no.
Okay, thank you. Okay, well set, you understand the bottom line, management information systems. In favor?
Unanimous.
Yes. Oh my goodness.
Unanimous.
Okay.
Madam
yes.
Chair, I would like to move the DPW budget.
Excellent.
The adjusted budget from Christie's handout. You might want to know OBS 17. That's the page.
But we're not going to use the handout.
Well, I'm using it. I'm using it, and the number that I'm going to put is for recommendation is 5,167,984. The reason I'm using that figure is that it reflects the change in gasoline and diesel.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Regina Barnes.
Chris, might as well come up before you fall asleep there. We don't want to get you all, we don't want to get you all bored.
So you went right to the bottom, huh?
Right.
Well, you might as well. It's one whole.
I'm missing a page. Oh, Ren.
Ladies coming?
We said Chris, so we were
thinking.
And Teresa. Yeah.
5,189,000
Folded.
072, something like that.
5,167,980
Okay. Bobby pops it
right.
Off.
Yeah,
thank you.
I'm all set.
Thank you.
I have my notes on
the old version.
That's right. Buy a saw.
She can't vote.
That's all right.
She takes the notes.
They keep you up late plowing, did they?
No.
No. All right. Oh, yeah, yeah. So far, so good?
You don't want to be plowing.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions to start off? Otherwise, we'll let Mr. Jacobs have a little chat. Go ahead, Brian.
Red Street. What's that? Was this an emergency, or is this something that was...
Yeah, there was a discovered Monday. Mm-hmm. Thought it was a pothole. Come to find out it's a sinkhole.
Ah.
We'd inspected that particular pipe twice in the last year. Mainly due to the head wall damage that was done at Brad Street. Visual inspection inside showed no defects, but structurally from the outside it was insufficient, and it just collapsed.
Now, will that come out of this year's budget, or?
Oh, we're into 17.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I mean, we had the piece of pipe, so what That's came out of the budget is gasoline, you know, some gravel. We already had the processed gravel, so, and the paving when it warms up enough.
Good. That just made me nervous. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Pierce.
Did you have an opportunity to look at the transfer question I had for you about the transfer station?
I can't hear you, Michael.
The transfer station.
Jennifer had all the questions down. Was that one that you remember?
The difference between using one person and two people.
Well, no, there used to be a part-time person working at the transfer station. And you haven't replaced him, and you've got three people working overtime now.
The Teamsters union contract specifies that the manager of the transfer station, it's a Teamster position.
Well, I hand you the copy of the union's contract, and that's not what it says right on the first page. It specifically eliminates that from being a consideration from the union contract. Right on the front page of the union contract. I gave you the copy of that whole mess last time you were here.
I've read that equally as well as you have, and I guess I would have to disagree, respectfully.
I don't understand how you can come to that conclusion, but
it's a negotiated contract. I have no authority to override that contract.
And it says very specifically in the contract that it's not a union position.
Didn't we ask which contract you were printing from?
Mark Richardson's position as manager of the transfer station is a Teamster position. Yeah. And on the weekends, it is a Teamster position. And the Teamsters have elected to fill that position. They had reached previously agreement with the former director that could they use a part-time person 3 out of 4 weekends,
in the contract.
And they acquiesced to that. When he left, they no longer acquiesced to that provision.
It was in the contract from 14 to 16, so the contract would still be in place when you've changed it, is my problem. I mean, it's going to end up costing the town a few thousand dollars when you could have a person doing that for part-time. And you're going to be paying people
not without a union grievance.
And we were already doing that way. You did.
We are not doing that currently. We have not been doing it for almost 18 months that way.
Well, why are you just now putting in overtime and reducing the part-time wages then if you've just already been doing it for 18 months?
Because by the time we actually get down to negotiating the contract and or preparing this budget, that's when we got caught up to it.
So you haven't, this is in your new contract that the voters haven't approved yet, you mean?
No.
Because the one that had what I said was still in effect in 2016.
And I just said I respectfully disagree with you. I believe your interpretation of the contract to be wrong. If you think I'm wrong, please take it up with the town manager. End of discussion.
Chair.
Okay, wait one second. Further questions on this side? Okay. Tim?
Welcome back.
Yes, good to be back.
Good to have you for all three of you.
He said that with a straight face, too.
You know, you can't go by without discussing federal stormwater requirements, right?
Right.
As you recall, last we discussed, I asked, well, you know, you guys have some clue what we need to test for public health, right? And
right.
You said you'd get back to me. And so I assume you've done that workup. And so how much money do you need to do that?
So I prepared a memo knowing that on November 29, 2016, you asked this question. And basically, I put together this saying that due to the natural resources located in Hampton, we have been designated a small municipal stormwater system community. This is the MS4 permit that you generally hear about and that we are still awaiting the new permit. It is in the interest of the town, whether required by a new permit, the existing permit, or no permit at all, to ensure that our natural resources are protected and to be able to continue to support the commercial and recreational activities that depend on them. We have implemented and are required to implement stormwater requirements for our developers and our own activities, i.e. the DPW's activities and any other town departments throughout town. In order to accomplish this, funding is necessary to develop best management practices for the town and to ensure that they are followed throughout and after the construction processes. As part of these practices, and as one example, the DPW needs to identify all of our stormwater outfalls and understand if the outfalls contain pollutants such as oils, grease, and bacteria in order to identify the problems the outfalls may have, if they do have them, and then any remediation that may be required. This process has been started, and we currently have identified our outfalls, have mapped them using GIS, and have ordered the signs for the placement. So that is stuff that we have talked about in the past and money that we have spent. To expand on these efforts, funding is necessary to continue with pollutant testing at outfalls, development of the stormwater pollution plans that are required, and to cover outreach efforts that are needed to involve the public in protecting the town's resources. The funding requested will also help to cover the construction associated with stormwater quality improvements, ongoing maintenance, and the replacement of the current town BMPs. When you hear the word BMPs, it stands for best management practices. If you want to relate that to activities that the department does, that's your repair of drainage structures, outfalls, the rock that you see at the end of it with the weeds, the pruning, the trimming of any of the wooded vegetation around any of the detention or retention areas that's not supposed to be there because it could affect the berm and therefore have troubles. The replacement of oil-absorbing materials, i.e. making sure we are stocked if there are any type of oil spills. And then I finish the sentence off, as well as the continued efforts to follow up on pollution identification, detection, and elimination. That's something that we work with the wastewater system, as opposed to the fats, the oils, the grease that Chris has talked about. When that winds up in our drainage, that's our stormwater problem. When people are putting poop down our drains from their dogs, that's a stormwater problem. These are man hours, these are efforts, these are vacuuming, these are equipment that we need to vacuum. The list is all associated. Within the limited staff of the Public Works Department and the increasing demands of our services, it may be necessary to subcontract some of the work that will need to be accomplished. Funding for the department would allow us to continue with stormwater management practices and expand on them to include construction site runoff control. This is a requirement, and that would include resident engineering services. That's an example of, say, the Bicentennial Wall Project, for example. We have hired consultants, i.e. engineers, down there monitoring that construction. Chris and I can't be down there and do our jobs all at the same time. That takes dollars. Post-construction runoff control. This is the construction of new BMPs, so new swales, new riprap, new detention areas, new water quality outlets, new recharge areas, new rain gardens. Also, the inspection of these systems. Every year by December, every facility that has been permitted through the planning department has to write an operation and maintenance plan. Their engineer presents us a report. We spend the time to read their report. The things that we don't agree with their reports, we go out and we make comments. So that's time again.
Sometimes in the past, we've used our stormwater consultant to do that work, some of the subcontractors. The actual repairing of the riprap, the swales, the retention, that is our own staff. Toby has been out on, help me with the street, Muncie Drive, working on those last two detention basins in the last 2 years. The illicit discharge detection elimination, this is the testing of the outfalls, to answer your question. This is lab equipment, which we did use some of the funding last year and have another purchase coming up to test for these oils, the facts, the bacteria. The bacteria is also similar to the bacteria that we were testing for when we had the sewer force main breach. Again, as much as sewers and drains are different, you don't want them colliding, so we do test for fecal in our drains, not just our stormwater. The pollution mitigation, again, this is about consultants, lab equipment analysis. At one point, I did do up testing the fecal twice a week just for the force main break. Averages out to be almost $250 between the equipment, the time, the materials, the lab costs, and you do that every year, you know, times the 12. So these are all numbers that got put together. One of the major components of the new permit, and I'm doing this fairly fast because we have a lot to cover, the public education outreach. Not only is it something that we've tried, you've seen the thing on Channel 22, we've done it through the selectmen, we've done it here. There are flyers in our office. Don't flush things down the toilet, but don't put things down our storm drains. Again, we're talking the drainage.
Right.
Part of the new permit is you actually have to measure how many people you're reaching out to. It's going to be more survey-oriented. It's more outreach materials. There are now professionals currently every single day sending us emails about their marketing that they can help do within our town. So this is funding to get help with meetings that where we bring in advocates and professionals, those that can sit here and demonstrate and do presentations, as well as putting together the mailings, postings, and flyers. Public participation involvement follows that right hand behind. That's how you're going to measure the progress. Again, new permit doesn't mean we can't be doing it now. All the stuff that we do now helps us in the future. That's workshops, surveys, and training sessions for anybody who wants to know how to do the rain gardens. There's Soak Up New Hampshire. I know the Conservation Commission does it. But this all falls in the MS4 and through the MS4 permit and that line, which I believe is adequately named just federal stormwater requirements. We currently have a permit. That's a reminder. We have requirements we currently have to follow. And then there's always the pollution prevention and the good housekeeping. This is all about erosion control and setting up policies and procedures for how we prevent the pollution through our operations and those in towns. So it's a summary of what we're doing, what we need to do, and what we need to expand upon. And that's what the money is being used for.
And if you ask Jennifer a question, you get a response.
DPW activity, as opposed to just the one line I'm asking for.
No, most of that was all for the stormwater regulations. We have a drainage repair line, so that's when something breaks, we need to fix it.
We have a lab analysis line as well. And
that's for our wastewater sewer plant, which we're required under our sewer permit. Again, we're talking drainage.
Right, well, that's what I'm saying. It sounds like you were covering a whole lot.
No, I kept trying to go back that the MS4 is for drainage. Again, I'll say it again. The MS4 is for drainage. There's a lot of crossover.
Will you actually be testing for the first time in 2017?
Will we be doing testing?
Yeah.
We've been doing testing now.
We're currently doing the testing.
I understand.
For bacteria.
I did preparation work last year.
Since we've had the...
Since February, since the sewer break of last February, we've agreed as part of our stipulation with DES...
Testing for fecal matter.
To test for fecal matter.
Right.
And in the open water.
My question in the prior meeting, and it's still today, what else do you need to test for good public health relative to, instead of just fecal, but is there not other stuff that you need to test as well?
It's fecal, it's pollutants. Those are all the things
will
that
you be testing for those
oil?
In 2017? Mm-hmm. That's really all I wanted to know.
Okay. And that
15,000, is 50,000 is just the right number to do that?
And to put together pollution and prevention plans.
If it's not, I'll have to take it from other budgets.
Right.
Or that's
so you're saying it might be low, but it's definitely not high.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you
for that.
Very very simple questions. One further up here. Remember that song from the 50s, Mr. Sandman? That was a very nice song. Wasn't that a nice song? Anyway, our Sandman isn't here, as you know. Jerry Zinnoy. have to pay homage to him whenever Sand has an opportunity here. We had Sand being discussed.
Are you going to sing it?
You're in Winter Sand?
I probably could,
Tim,
actually.
Tim, give a reference. Where are you on?
But I have a sore throat, Bob, so sorry.
Are you on OBS 16? Salt and Winter Sand?
Yeah.
Is that where we are?
Yeah.
Okay, it's just so people could look at there. Okay, what's the problem with Sand?
Well, we keep funding it and we don't buy it.
Well, you don't know.
There again, it's a what? $13,000 line.
Yeah.
A $5 million budget. Yes, due to last year's mild winter and the winter before, if you'd have put sand on that much snow that fell, you'd have just, well, been wasting it. Very prudently, we haven't bought any sand because, well, the cupboard is full. Do I, in the grand scheme of things, for $13,000, cut it if you feel that you must, but I'll still buy sand.
Question.
If I need it,
last time
I need
we discussed it, he had no intention of buying sand.
But I, you know,
unless he needs
a number of times over the last 5 or 6 times we've met, we've always referred back to that beautiful crystal ball. I don't have that crystal ball. Okay. I don't know that crystal ball.
No.
And yes, I have enough sand, I believe, to make it through this winter. But if I run where I need more sand, if every third day is an ice storm and I go through all the sand that I have, yeah, I will be buying sand.
Good.
Go ahead.
Mr. Jones, go ahead, Steve.
You asked a question.
I asked the question about the sand when you...
She actually knows more about that.
Okay. When, before the meeting started, that's what I was talking to her about. Every year, the Hampton Beach Village District buys 300 tons of sand for a sand sculpture event. Now, my understanding is from Greg Grady, the person that we runs the thing for us.
Can we hear you? Are you near the microphone? Because
they can hear me.
The public's got to be able to hear you.
I'm sure they can. The thing that I want to know is that Greg has told us, my understanding is that when we take the sand off the beach, and that sand has to be removed because it's different from beach sand.
Right.
My understanding is that we donate it to the town of Hampton, and that's why I was asking you about it, but you weren't aware of it.
No.
Are any of you aware of that? I wonder where the sand's going.
No.
It's being removed from the beach, and my understanding was that it's being donated to the town.
No, it's being disposed of. Yeah. It's contaminated.
Yeah.
Well, I've just learned something. Thank you.
I do know one thing, though.
I'm sorry.
The sand that we buy is very coarse, very rough. The beach sand sculpture sand, let's say, is very uniform.
It's fine.
Clay.
Very fine.
Clay. Yeah, it's very, very fine. If I were to use it on my roads, and Mike's probably got more experience with this, it would probably make the road slicker. It wouldn't really give us traction. So it isn't a product that I would readily use. I
kind of like putting baby powder down. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, I stand corrected.
But having done it for years, I know they dispose of it because it's because of the glue and everything else. It's also contaminated.
And it has such a dramatic different consistency that I think I would have noticed it in our sand pile. Our sand pile is very, very coarse.
He doesn't let anybody sneak into the sand pile.
Is it still true you don't plan on buying sand next year?
I have enough sand in my cupboard.
Good.
You don't plan on buying it.
But if I run out between now and...
Oh, of course, but you don't plan on buying it, so we shouldn't plan on budging it. That's
No.
What do you mean, no, no?
No.
If you don't plan on spending or buying something, then you don't put money aside for it.
In a hypothetical situation, which we've tended to do before, we have 2 winters still to go through. We have this winter to finish, and we have the winter starting November, December. So if we take the sand that's in our cupboard now, just say, because we get the ice storms, it's getting cold, although nothing in the forecast, being very thankful for that, and we do use all the sand up,
mm-hmm.
we would need money in this year's budget
right.
to get us for November, December. Or maybe it doesn't snow, but if it did and we needed it, we'd need some money to buy sand. Or we hit that point and we have nothing in our budget, we can't replenish, and then what happens? We're going to buy it anyway, which is exactly what Chris said.
Okay. We're always dealing in the future.
Right.
With the budget.
Exactly.
And thus, we're always dealing with hypotheticals.
And we're always projecting. So there's a hypothetical that could happen.
That's why I asked the man if he's planning on buying it or not. Now, if he has a plan that he's going to need it, then I need to know that. But I'm not hearing that.
He has accommodated.
In fact, what he said at the last meeting on this topic was, quote, he won't lose any sleep over it if he loses that budget line item.
The director has...
I mean, what am I to deduce from that?
Tim, the director has provided for the possibility of a purchase of sand later in the year by putting this in his budget. Mr. LaBranche?
You have had so far this year two extraordinary events take place, one being a broken...
No side conversations. We can't hear.
One being a broken pipe in the middle of a marsh,
yep.
And then another extraordinary situation where you've had to buy huge boulders to protect a seawall. Neither one of those things were budgeted on a specific line item because you didn't know they were going to happen.
Right.
Your department is of such that this type of thing can happen, and when you need money to fix a pipe in the middle of the marsh and you have $13,000 in the sand budget, that's probably where some of it's going to come from, along with a lot of others, because you have to become creative.
Yes.
So there's this crystal ball that he does not have, but he has things that happen. For instance, two winters ago when you had 10 feet of snow, and again you had an extraordinary situation.
Right.
Things happen. And DPW, they certainly, the opportunity is there, so...
Right.
I congratulate you on your wonderful job that you and your staff do. Thank you very much.
Let's double the sand line.
Double
the insurance.
That's silly.
No, it isn't Chris, silly, Madam Chair.
Yes, it is silly.
The same argument to doubling it is to keep it the way it is.
Chris, came out of your pocket and you dropped it on the ground. I just don't want you to...
Oh, papers, thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
This line, along with a number of other lines within our budget... We're in the emergency business as much as the police department is or the fire department is. It's probably sometimes not as dramatic like a major fire, smoke and people's senses with that. But at the same time, major snow where we're not able to move around is very problematic.
Yeah.
Discharges of untreated wastewater out into the marsh. Very, very problematic. So, the only thing I can say with respect to the sand line and other smaller lines like that is they are risk aversion lines. We are better off with them in the budget rather than nickeling out the budget to trim it to a too tight of a line. It all gets down to level of service and risk. And we, like the police and fire, will respond with whatever funds the taxpayers give us. And in the grand scheme of things, continually, Mr. Jones, in a previous deliberative session or meeting session, you asked, you know, okay, that $13,000, what does that equate to the tax rate? Would this even be one-tenth of one? I don't know, but it would be a very, very... minimal amount.
No, it's a matter of being accurate in this case. I don't ask about the tax rate effect on any line items. I do warrant articles.
Okay.
And what I'm interested in is having a budget. This is accurate as we can get it. Now, this number, $13,877, I mean, as far as I can remember, I've been here 4 years, I see that same number every year.
Right.
I mean, so that raises a flag. So how can that be the right number every year? And how can the actuals always be zero? I mean, I think it was even zero a couple of years ago when we had those huge storms.
One of the reasons why you'll never see the number go lower is there's a fear amongst those of us that prepare a budget is that it'll never come back up at all. In reality.
What do you mean it'll never come back up?
Okay, we've about beaten that.
What do you mean it'll never come back up?
That, yeah, if we go to a default budget or something like that.
Oh, okay, so this is a means of keeping the default budget up.
No, I didn't say that. Oh. It's a means of having a fair representative number in the budget for something that would be, it's a risk aversion amount.
But you mentioned the default budget.
Okay. It was the mention behind me, and that's I picked it up.
Okay.
Right. So the default budget is in play in your consideration. Point. Yes.
Mr. Kravitz is moving the question.
Yes, thank you.
Oh, we have a new rule, do we?
Well, enough, you know.
I mean, it's in the middle of sentence answering my question, Madam Chair. And you create a rule that says anyone can ask the question.
Planning.
Well, a gentleman is answering the question.
Yes.
I got it. I got the rule.
He has...
Second.
Describe.
I move the question.
Will you stop?
No, I think that's okay. I think we're pretty comfortable.
Ready to vote
on salt. Yeah. Well, do you really need to vote?
Yes.
Oh, I mean, you want the whole.
You got to move. If he moves the question, then that takes precedence over everything else, Mary Louise.
Right. Okay, so
you're moving the question on the total budget.
Yeah.
I have a quick question under, and we're not going to go into this forever, on the waste collection. Is there any hope in your life for cutting back on the waste that's crippling you?
You mean solid waste?
Yes, sir.
No, it's an inherent
Selectmen would have
part of being... I'm answering your question with respect to the tonnage.
Yeah.
Towns grow. Hampton is a very vibrant community.
Yeah.
20% growth rate, or 16-18% growth rate in the not only the capital amount of the town, i.e. buildings and things of that nature, but then also 16% or 20% growth rate, depending on which number you look at, in the actual taxable value of the town and
right.
the properties that you all enjoy. So obviously this is a desirable community. More people will come. I don't ever see the waste load decreasing.
Right.
Unless society in its practices dictates a change.
It's just a dreadful burden on your department. Mike?
I'd like to follow up on that. Are you doing anything to promote recycling in town like we used to do?
Well, for instance, yes. For instance, in the my annual report that's just been submitted, I've asked everybody in every community, could you all just recycle one more pound per day per week? That would equate to tons of savings, because we pay, right now we're only one of two communities in the state that pays zero per ton to dispose of recycling, Nashua and ourselves. We're lucky. We have four more years of this recycling at nothing per ton. Now, I still have to pay $300 a truckload to transport it somewhere, but at least I'm not, like other communities, paying $75 and $85 a ton to dispose of recyclables.
Yeah.
So it's in the taxpayers' hands.
Right.
Recycle more, save yourself some money.
How do you get this out to...
Mary Louise, can I just ask a question?
Yes.
If you had to move the question, and it's been seconded, you can't keep talking until you vote on moving the question.
She gets to make up rules at her will.
I'm sorry, or you can change the rules, I guess.
We can have the rules any way we want.
Well, I guess so. Then don't.
Are we going to vote?
Who seconded? You seconded.
Who knows?
Stop. You seconded, Mr. Kravitz?
Yes, I did.
Oh, you, Mr. Ladd seconded.
Bob Ladd did. 20 minutes ago.
Mr. Kravitz did move the question on the entire operating budget. All right, in favor of going ahead with that. Okay.
The entire operating budget of what amount?
Public Works, $5 million.
Oh, okay, just the Public Works.
Yes.
Not the entire budget, okay.
No, although
public
that
works budget.
Yeah.
Next.
Yeah.
What are you doing, Mike?
I'm voting for.
Okay. And what are you doing, Mr. Jones?
I'm abstaining.
Okay, Mr. Jones is abstaining. Thank you.
I was in the bathroom, remember?
I didn't follow you down.
Okay, now you have to vote on the bottom line.
Yeah, you voted on the movement. Now we
to move. Okay, so now we're going to the main motion for $5,167,984.
I'll second.
Mr. Henderson seconded. You understand the intent of the motion?
Yes.
Grand total on public
in
works?
In favor, grand total on public works. Regina, are you live down there? Good. Okay. Unanimous. Mr. Jones?
No, I will go along. I love DPW so much that, I mean,
okay.
Even though I have some issues that weren't allowed to be addressed fully,
Madam,
I can't resist but say yay.
I'm Mr. Jones.
Madam, I can't resist but to say yay on DPW's
yes,
budget.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move the police department for recommendation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sit down.
Thank you.
Yes, wait a minute. Barbara has a question. Thank you, ladies.
And Ms. Barnes as the second.
Yes, she originally seconded my motion. That is correct.
Okay.
I would like to move the amount of $4,100,000.
Stop the side talk because we can't hear people. Okay.
Again.
That's not funny.
The number 4100501.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Bond.
Just a minute, I can find it.
OBS 10.
There you go.
What was the number again?
4,100,000.
4,100,000. OBS 10.
Okay. And it was seconded by Regina?
Seconded by Ms. Barnes. All righty. Yeah. Repeat the total one more time.
4100501, and that is the new number from Christie that reflects the changes in gasoline/diesel.
Okay, gasoline. Okay, Chief and Deputy. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Does anyone have a question, or do you want to hear a quick recap from the chief?
Go ahead. I would like to make one comment. On Tuesday night, we talked about the animal control line, which falls under the police department.
It's technically a separate budget. It's called Health and Human Services.
But it's police officer.
I oversee it, but actually it's Pete.
Oh, Peter.
But it is technically a separate budget from the police budget.
Just wanted to clarify something, because on Tuesday night, the gas line was changed from 6,000 something down to a little less than 2,000, and there were some people here that thought that number, they wondered how it could possibly change so much. And it occurred to me last night, and I wanted to point out, I know that Christy, you said he has a van now. He used to have a pickup truck that had a plow rig on the front, and he used to go around plowing.
Yeah.
And so that would very much make up the difference between pushing snow and just driving around in a van.
Much more fuel-efficient vehicle.
There you go. So that's the explanation for the other night. I just wanted to make sure that on the record people knew what was going on with
that. And that's a good thought.
Appreciate that.
Okay. Do you, ladies and gentlemen, have questions for the chief, or do you want a recap from the chief?
We already
went through the review.
Okay. Well, we're just finalizing right now. Anything unusual happening, or is what? What, Mike?
I was looking for
questions. What's your question?
I was yielding to Mr. Jones.
Mr. Jones doesn't have any questions.
Yes.
I'll
move
I don't. I'll call him tomorrow or so. I don't, by acclamation, have any questions.
Okay.
However, I do have a statement.
Oh.
Well, can we move it?
Let's move it.
Yeah, don't forget to get the ball moving right away here. I cannot support this, Chief. Not that I don't support the police. You know I do. I think you know that. But there is $30,000 in here for what you call outside agencies.
Yep.
For private details from outside agencies.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, subsequent research has shown me that in 2016, you spent $20,000 out of the...
Fund 26.
Yeah, I don't know why it's called that, but the actual
That's
name...
That's what it's always been called.
Yeah, but the fact is, it's actually called the Hampton Private Detail Revolving Fund. Right? Hampton Private Detail Revolving Fund. That's the actual name, passed in 2006, Warren Article 21. Okay?
Yes. Not to correct you, but I'll go with what you're saying.
Yes.
I got it right here.
Anyway, got it right here. Fund 26, private detail.
The purpose of this fund is to be expended to fund the costs of police and fire department private details. And money was spent out of that fund, $20,000, for the what you call outside agencies.
Yep.
I believe that that was correct thing to do in 2016. And I believe that 2017 is no different. It's the correct place to get the money in 2017. It does not belong in the budget. There's a fund for that activity. We don't need to fund it in the line item. I am not going to get support on the budget committee to reduce that. But I wanted you to know why I'm voting against the police budget. It's not that I don't support the police. I do. And I do want to fund this activity. I disagree wholeheartedly in principle on funding it in the budget. And that's all I have to say. There's no question there.
And if I could comment back, though.
Yeah. Oh, no, you can't. Because
I think I probably will, though.
Just one way or the other.
Tim, I respect your opinion on it. I know that was a little bit of a discussion here, and I understand. Just understand that this was a new thing we did last year, and it was in a reaction to a very difficult time we were experiencing. When Fund 26 was created, it wasn't created in anticipation of that circumstance. It was there, and it was a useful tool to use. So that's how I utilized it. My feeling is, and I know we're going to differ on this, I just want you to understand where I'm coming from. Time and again, I've come before this committee, and I kind of see what you're saying. I hear the word transparency, and you and I have talked about clarifying lines in there. So the average person can look at it and understand what we're trying to say. And I'm truly trying to accomplish that. And that's just strictly where we differ a little bit on this issue. I believe that if this is going to be an operational expense for the foreseeable future, then that's where it belongs. That's the only difference I have with you.
I understand. Well, plus the fact that you characterize the fund different than I do. The purpose of the fund is, as stated in the Warren article, funds may be expended only to fund the cost of police and fire department private details. That's what that activity is. That's what this fund is designed to do. And you should continue using this fund for that reason. We can achieve the transparency you seek and still use this fund. It doesn't have to be in the budget for the transparency. I am certainly, I'm a big time guy on transparency, especially when it comes to your radio maintenance line, right?
Yep.
So, that's why I'm voting against it. I support the police department. I want you to understand my negative vote.
I appreciate your thoughts on it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Go ahead.
I just had one quick question. Are you still going to continue to do two classes next year or try to get two classes?
Yes. What we're finding is this year you'll see we're going to bring 9 new officers, hopefully, into the lineup for the summer. We accomplished that by running a test in April.
Yeah.
And then we ran one again in October.
Right.
So the totality of that numbers as we got down to it was 9. It right now as we sit here today, I actually just finished my last interview today for the class that starts the academy in February.
It's a lot better than 2.
It's the only way we can keep up, Brian, because it's such a competitive market. Yeah. And I'm hoping that maybe we start turning the corner here in the future and recruitment gets back to where it is.
I think it was a fantastic idea.
But I think it's going to be a little while. Mm-hmm. And so my opinion is we should continue to run the 2 classes because that's the only way we're ever going to come close to the numbers we need to get back to where we were.
Super. Thank you.
Okay.
I assume, gentlemen, that we're talking about the training and recruitment line.
I'm assuming that's the line he's referring to.
Brian, the line that you're referencing? $19,527.
Or if you don't mind, if I could throw one other thing out of there. I just got some excellent
news. Excuse me, Chief. We're not talking on the side. It screws up the microphones, and it's rude. Okay.
I got some good news today. Unofficial, it hasn't happened yet, but I expect to have a visit tomorrow from representatives of the New Hampshire Police Academy. As you recall, they had to discontinue having us as a host for the Satellite Academy, which I think is a great advantage for us, recruitment-wise and for monitoring our training.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the change that the governor signed into law in 16, where the academy is no longer funded by the penalty assessment fund, it's a straight line budget in the state budget. We believe we're going to be able to accomplish that again for this upcoming class in February. At least that's the target goal, is to get that up and running by the February academy. So we'll be hosting the part-time academy again at Hampton PD for the Seacoast region.
And if you get that for February, the one in the fall, hopefully.
Yes. As long as the budget's there for the state, we can continue that program.
Maybe cover you for both.
Yeah.
Move the question.
Wait one second.
I had my hand up before.
Yeah, Mike has a question. You have a question, Steve?
Brief one.
Because he was raising his hand.
I just have a brief one. What's the chance of bringing back state police next year as far as their budget and whatever?
It's, again, Riffs, their budget is not the issue, Steve. It's not. Their budget is fine. They're going to add money. They are in a critical situation like we are. Their recruitment right now has fallen behind. Mm-hmm. I spoke to the Assistant Commissioner of Safety yesterday on the topic. I've spoken to the new colonel and Lieutenant Vetter about getting a little bit ahead of the planning cycle for ourselves. Because as you recall, I used to meet with my counterpart from the state police when I was deputy chief every April, and we would lay out the calendar for the summer as to how many details we would get. That worked when we all had sufficient officers and budgets, but it's not really a cost-efficient way to manage it. We now do this on a weekly basis. The deputy here will contact the Troop A lieutenant, and they will coordinate the needs for the beach operation based on weather and events, which is two driving forces down there for our staffing. If we can get it from the state police, we absolutely will, because, of course, that's less impact to the taxpayer. But there are going to be those times we've seen where we had weekends where we had no troopers or minimal coverage. So that's just right now the rut we're in. I obviously cherish the relationship I have with the state police. It's been great. In any way we can enhance that, we're going to. But right now, we're all kind of in the same boat. So we're trying to all share resources where we can. We've demonstrated that with some of the grants we're doing. I haven't brought it before the board yet, but it's coming. We just entered into a grant with the UNH Police Department, Durham and Laconia, for a piece of equipment, one of those sky towers, the elevated towers, so we can have an observation platform elevated that we'll all utilize, no tax impact to the taxpayer. We'll share that resource. We're guaranteed for the events that we have because they're different than UNH and Laconia. So anywhere we can try to share resources, minimal impact to the taxpayer, that's what we will try to accomplish.
And my second question is going to be the part-time civilian technician.
Yep.
I see that on the budget for 22,000, certain hours, et cetera. Is that something that's really needed? Do we really have enough evidence,
you know, absolutely,
in order to have somebody work part-time?
Looking at that, you may have recalled I brought up before the board the potential of trying to add full-time personnel. And obviously, right now, we have a lot of departments with needs for personnel. But the problem you're up against in this environment is health costs, and ma'am, you mentioned the retirement issues.
Yeah.
They could be significant to the taxpayer. So I don't think there's going to be a lot of will right now, even if I could get grants to add full-time personnel. So what the trend is and what you're seeing, and I've looked at other departments that have done this, is you take certain aspects of the job we do that don't require a sworn person to do.
Right.
Now, right now, if you have an evidence custodian and it's a sworn person, that means they're responsible to go down each day, particularly on Mondays after a busy weekend, catalog all that evidence, make sure it's been entered properly, and a lot of that stuff has to go up to the lab. Now, that's a ride up to Concord and back. You wait in line a lot of times. And to me, that's not a useful deployment of a sworn person that should be working on criminal investigative cases. That can be done by somebody that's a civilian technician, and you're seeing that as a trend in law enforcement. Many of those things is evidence collection, and the evidence rooms are now being conducted by civilian employees. This will be a part-time employee with no benefits. For, I think it's 28 hours a week. We cap that at based on federal changes to the insurance laws.
Yeah. And the way the new building was constructed, the evidence area, if I recall, was pretty well self.
It's very secure. There's a limited number of people. I don't even have access to it. Only certain people have access to it. In order for me to go into the evidence room, I have to be accompanied by an evidence custodian.
Okay. You all set? Mike had.
Okay. The question I was going to bring up is the $30,000 that you asked for the outside agencies that Mr. Jones already talked about. I feel I should come out of the revolver, because I can remember when we passed the revolver in 2006, you and I were both there, as you recall, talking about it, in fact, at the deliberation session. And I think it's important to realize that this is money now you're asking the taxpayers to pay for, and it should be, in my opinion, should be coming out of the revolver.
The only problem with it, Mike, is I understand your thought on it, and again, I respect Tim's, but the one thing you're forgetting is when we pay a Hampton officer out of that fund, we then send a bill to the private vendor, okay, to reimburse it plus 30%. That's why that number grows the way it does.
Right.
When I pay out to an outside agency, we're not getting anything back. So that's going to deplete that fund. Now, we have to. You're hoping, and I believe probably for the foreseeable future with the growth of the town, that the reimbursements we get plus the 30% will offset that payout. I hope. But what happens if it doesn't, and I have other needs for that, such as equipment needs? We do utilize that line sometimes to outfit cruisers as part of what it's allowed to be used for. So my only problem with that, in the immediate, if we did it next year, I don't think it would catastrophically affect that fund. But over the course of time, it could put a big dent in that because, again, Hampton Office Works of Detail, we pay them out of that fund. Mm-hmm. You get reimbursed by the vendor plus 30% that goes back into that fund. That keeps that level up.
So how much did we pay out last year?
Roughly $20,000 to outside agencies.
And the fee for the cruisers, too.
Correct. $14 an hour per hour for the cruisers. So I don't have a lot of heartburn over it. I just think we really need to be careful about this because down the road a piece, that could significantly deplete that fund.
Yeah.
Well, if we have a busy summer and we use it out of that.
But, Chief, we should keep our eye on all the funds. And this one as well. And if it's getting depleted, we should inflate it.
No, we're not.
We can add money to it.
No, you can't. You'd have to go to the voters for that.
Yeah. That's correct.
Yeah. Through a warrant article.
This is what you're asking to do with the budget committee. The budget. Be a warrant article. Same thing. We're going to have a warrant article that says,
our
fund is getting, like you said, it's not a catastrophe if we do it next year. By the end of next year, if we don't have over $100,000 like we do now, then we can say, we have a floor. We want to keep $100,000 in that fund. And it's getting close to $100,000, so let's have a warrant article to throw out another $50,000 into that fund to make sure that we're okay.
But here's the problem with that.
Now,
is if I funded cruisers the same way.
We're not talking cruisers.
No,
we're talking.
I'm using an example, if you could let me finish. I know that's hard for you sometimes to let me finish.
No. The lawyer won't entertain hypotheticals. Why should I?
I'm not giving you a hypothetical. I'm going to give you a reality. I don't fund cruisers by warrant articles because here's the problem. Every third year or so, a patrol cruiser needs to go because the mileage is getting excessive. Yeah. If I fund those cruisers through a warrant article and voters say no, mm-hmm. no means no law, which means right. I can't use alternative funding to buy cruisers. I'm stuck with a toilet that's going to break down as a guy's responding to a call, and that's not acceptable to me. And I look at that the same way. Well, right now, in the immediate, I don't think it's a problem. In the future, it could be a serious problem because if the voters don't come back and allow me to add money to that fund through the voting process, we're done.
No, it is not true. Because if they decide not to add money to a fund, that does not mean that you cannot use that fund. However, you could argue that if, in fact, this budget doesn't pass and the default budget does pass,
the consequence,
mm-hmm. then this line item doesn't exist because it's not in the default budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then you could say that if no means no, that means you can't do it at all. See, this actually is more applicable to no means no than a fund. A fund has nothing to do with no means no. Mm-hmm. No means no means, with regard to a fund, you're going to put money into it or not. No means no. We're not putting money into it. Doesn't mean we can't take money out for the intended purpose. Now, taking money out of the fund is entirely the decision of the town manager. Right? No vote required. That's what 26 says, Article 21, That the town manager is the one that is authorized to expend money from the fund for the purposes of costs of police and fire department private details.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Ginny.
Yes?
You were selectman in 2006, were
Absolutely.
You not?
Absolutely.
And you actually seconded this motion.
Absolutely.
At the deliberative session.
I did.
So regale us with your wisdom, please.
Give us your wisdom on that.
Yeah.
That we wanted a fund set up for that purpose.
Yes. There you go.
And then all the revenues received from that purpose would also be spent on that purpose. And that's why we set it up the same as the recreation department, the same as the other special revenue funds. That's what they're set up for. Interpretations are up to the department heads, I guess. And the police has changed what they want
to
do. It's up to the town manager.
Right.
The town manager. The police chief works for the town manager, so I'm sure he's coordinated that with him.
Right, and the only position I'm making is that on a principal level, you should have one source of funds for a given expenditure. We already have a fire hose of funds called the revolving fund.
Fire hose?
Well, I call $119,000 enough. He only wants 30 of it.
Stick to the subject.
So there's plenty of money in there to pay for that activity in 2017. And so I don't see any reason to be including it in the budget, based on the principle that you only need one source
to fund your expenses, not two. He's wanting the fund and the budget.
Now you're making me look greedy.
No.
Well, I don't mean you personally. You know what I mean.
Tim, I'm sorry.
If the one process, votes for the budget.
I have the same argument with the Conservation Commission.
No, I get you.
Same argument down the line with everyone. I treat everyone with the same principles. No one gets exceptions. I'm just not making motions. I don't want to waste the budget committee's time. I wanted to make that statement and leave it alone, but Pierce had to bring it back up because he's a troublemaker.
I've heard that.
We brought the officers from the outside.
I'm sorry, could you?
We brought the officers in from the outside and spent approximately $20,000.
Correct.
Is that correct? What was the average hourly rate that we're paying?
Steve, I haven't had a chance to look at that. I will try to get that to you, but I'm going to have to hand pull that because I'm not sure, as you know, the Hampton Police Department, the way we bill details is it's $35 an hour or the officer's overtime rate, whichever is greater. Now, some departments, they have a straight detail rate. Ours, it's mm-hmm. all, and most of the departments we deal with it, it's due to contractual obligations with their unions. I don't know what their contracts say, so I'd have to do a little research.
We're paying what all these departments, what their, whatever.
Correct. They bill us based on their rates, not ours.
So we're probably talking $45.
I would say somewhere in that ballpark would be accurate.
I'm just trying to figure out how this budget, you know, we took 20 out, you know, how the 30 is going to work.
The only reason it was 30 as opposed to the 20, I looked at when we started it last year, which was just before the 4th of July, when we got that program going. My goal this year is the moment the weather breaks and we start getting good weather, could be April, could be May, if it starts in March, you know, after if the voters give this appropriation, is to start this program immediately.
So, Bob, go ahead, and I have a quick question.
What's your position on the officers administering Narcan? And my second question would be, where are you at with body cameras?
Narcan is not something that I intend to issue to police officers at this particular juncture. I have spoken about this topic in the past. I'm not saying that it's the wrong thing to do in some communities, but right now, having spoken with the fire chief and the medical officer, based on the liability and the training issues, I think the public's best served by the fire professionals administering that. Now, if that's correct, we've all agreed that this is a fluid topic. If there was some reason that the fire department could no longer handle the volume of that issue, then we would reconsider that position. But right now, the town of Hampton, the fire department does an outstanding job dealing with this issue for us, and we're very coordinated in that. Just so you know, it's not me just arbitrarily saying no. I didn't feel comfortable making that decision until I spoke with Chief Ayotte and the medical officer, Nate Denio, and we're all in agreement. Right now, this is the proper way to approach that subject for the town of Hampton.
And body cameras.
Body cameras, you may recall a couple years ago, I had gone down the path of doing a warrant article for the body cameras.
Right.
But part of the problem was the state of New Hampshire had not developed a good law that we could follow, or understandable law, on how those could be properly used. Mm-hmm. Now, we do now have a law in the books, but I think a lot of departments are apprehensive about this because if I were to develop the body cameras, let's say I used the number of 80,000 2 years ago, so right now you can add 12% to that cost mm-hmm. over 2 years easily.
Here.
Now the other problem you're going to be developing is the issues of evidence, and you know we've had a lot of 91A talks here tonight. Well, you're going to have a lot of 91A talks if this happens, because I anticipate that if we went to body cameras, the volume of data that we would collect, the volume of requests we would get under either requests through the court actions or just 91A requests, I would have to hire a full-time person who solely handled those, because one of the things is if we come with a body camera into your whole property and it's on and all of these people are sitting there, and as I turn and look, you all wind up being on my video, but you're the only one that was the target, you're the one we arrest, I now have to buy a program and somebody that's trained to put that blurring on the faces. So that this goes out into the public, it's just like when we do a 91A request for arrest records and all that for people, a lot of that has to be redacted. We can't release dates of birth. We don't release addresses. There's a lot of confidential information, even though there's public information laws. Some of that's very confidential. What does that mean when you start doing 91A requests when it comes to body cameras?
Yeah.
That is really the hiccup in New Hampshire with body cameras not being as prevalent as you would have thought they would have been. So
nationally, they seem to be catching on quite a bit.
I think it's a mixed bag. I attended the IACP conference out in San Diego this year, and the number of vendors and the enthusiasm for it had dwindled considerably to the prior year because of these very same things. Many states are now enacting laws to govern the use of these body cameras, because it is invasive to your privacy, especially when we come on your property. What does that mean legally for us, what we can use, what we can't use, what do we have to redact? I support the use of body cameras, and I think most police officers do, as long as they're protected in that area. Because I think, when the cameras started coming out into cruisers, it exonerated more police officers than ever convicted. It showed that the officers, in most cases, were acting appropriately. Mm-hmm. And I believe that will be the case when body cameras become prevalent in the state of New Hampshire. It's just, how do we get there to the best benefit of the taxpayer? Because it's going to be expensive.
So you would suggest you need some state legislation?
There is state. Representative Cushing from Hampton was a co-sponsor, did a very nice job on it. It's not a criticism of the legislation. The law is in effect, so we have to abide by the law. The problem is you have these hiccups of how much data do you store, when can you deplete it, what are your redaction requirements based on requests from the public or arrest records. That's a lot. That's all new. It's all new stuff that we're trying to work our way through. And I just don't want to go down the road of spending taxpayer money in the sums of $90,000 or whatever, and then find out I bought the wrong program, or now I got to come back and ask for $60,000 for this program, and I got to add a full-time person. Yeah. I want to know what it's going to be before I come to you asking for that appropriation, and I'm not ready to come to you that yet. I support it, I'm just not ready for it.
What you say makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
I appreciate that. It's a hot-button topic.
Technology.
Yep.
Chief, one quick question. What is medical leave?
Medical leave.
Well, it says sick leave in the contracts.
What? Sick time being covered the shift.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you, Chris.
If someone is out on a sick day,
yeah,
and he covers the shift with another officer who's paid overtime, it comes out of that line item.
Oh,
okay. It's been in there all forever.
Oh, okay. So it's not a payroll line. It's a
payline.
People, right? All right. When people are working for you, in your stead, if you're injured or something. Okay. Are there further questions for the chief and deputy on our bottom line budget? $4,100,501.
Bottom line, police, right?
Yes, sir.
Police.
Yes. Okay. I've just forgot who moved the budget.
I moved the question. I'm sorry. I moved it for recommendation.
And Regina seconded. Okay. You understand the intent of the motion. If there are no further questions, what?
We understand.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure whether you.
All
right. In favor of moving to the public hearing, the 2017 Police Department budget, $4,100,501. Okay. Mr. Pierce, are you abstaining or opposing?
I'm opposing.
Opposing.
And I was waiting for the no vote.
Well, I've just got two of you. So, Mr. Jones, are you abstaining or opposing?
Nay.
Okay, so Pierce and Jones opposing. Everyone else is in favor. Thank you for what you do.
Thanks, Chief.
And we will be at the public hearing on the 12th.
Thank you for your time and consideration.
Of January.
Thank you. Good night. Madam Chair, would you entertain a motion for adjournment?
Yeah, I'll second.
Do we have to move the bottom line?
The real bottom line.
So. Oh, I'm so sorry.
We have to make sure with.
But you know what? If we move the bottom line,
okay. Alrighty, I just want to make sure.
Yeah, don't help us now. We're right at the bottom line here.
Yeah.
Christy, what do you have for the bottom line?
Madam Chair, I would like to make a motion.
Wait a minute. Wait, because I just want to make sure that we're not.
Christy, what do you have
for
the bottom
line? You aren't skipping anything, Mary Louise, if you move the bottom line.
No. I know, but I want to make sure that, because I don't remember every little
motion. Madam Chair.
But you don't have to worry. It's coming if you move the bottom line.
Madam Chair.
Okay.
May I inquire to Christy what she has for the bottom line now?
I have a total of, just for changes that were made, I have a total of $6,260 of changes made by the budget committee.
Okay.
$5,000 in recreation and $1,260 in the gas line for the cemetery department. Those are the only changes that I have recorded.
Correct.
Okay. Now, the lifeguards are still set at $1, right?
The lifeguards was one of the questions I was going to ask, because I don't know if that was ever.
We voted on that.
Okay.
Yeah, we voted.
Let me change that, and then I will give you a bottom line.
Thank you. So let's wait for Christy so we don't have an argument over what the number is, please.
And then the pass outs.
Well, we haven't been able to. We added more money to it last year.
Yeah.
In hopes that more money would attract them.
Right.
It didn't work.
So what did
so
we do?
So we inquired, well, even if we double it, will we get them? And the answer from management was not likely.
Okay.
So it was like, well, why fund it? We're not going to get
so
it.
So you zero.
You zero that or you put a dollar on it?
$1.
$1.
Yeah. It was Mr. Pierce's motion for $1.
Okay. Yeah, it's very difficult. And when we convene at the public hearing on the 12th, Christy will have the up-to-date paperwork to show us the exact, after the changes and the gasoline and all that good stuff, she will have the accurate bottom line.
Right, the delivery session is what day?
12th. A week from
Public hearing.
I mean, sorry about that. I mean public
hearing. Deliberative session's February.
Yeah, February 4th. Yeah.
February 4th.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry about that. I mean the public
hearing. Well, the reason I'm asking is we're waiting for Christy anyway. I wanted to remind the new members that we also have a brief budget committee meeting immediately following the deliberative session, which is on February 4th, where we may or may not vote on anything that changed during the course of the deliberative session.
Right.
Okay.
But right now,
so in addition to the public hearing, we have that brief meeting after the deliberative session, right there in the auditorium.
Right.
Hmm.
Is it just public?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, sure.
Everything we do is public.
Yeah.
On camera, you're gonna go back.
Yes.
You can go back and pick up any of these we didn't do.
I'm sorry.
We did them all.
Once you prove the bottom line, Michael, that takes care of everything.
Yeah.
We didn't come tonight, though, is what I'm trying to say.
We're gonna bother to wait for Christy to come up with the number. You have it, Christy?
I have your bottom line number.
Give it to us.
Okay. And I will trust that it's absolutely correct. Absolutely. I trust it. Absolutely.
You said you would trust
it. No, I do trust it. I hereby do trust Christy's number.
Christy,
the number.
Please.
$26,836,977.
I so move.
Madam Chair, I would so move.
Well,
the number of $26,836,977.
Okay.
I have a second.
Okay, well, Mr.
Second.
Give it to him.
He wants
to
let him have it.
Oh, I was going to say, really Mr. Jones. All right. Mr. LaBranche has moved, and Mr. Lapham seconded?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay, in favor of the corrected total operating budget figure.
Can we have a discussion before we vote?
Well, yeah.
That's a good idea, Mike. That's an interesting idea. We can actually have a discussion before a vote.
They're running down. If you want to discuss, yes.
I'd like to make a motion to modify the number by, and decrease it by $519,000.
Where?
$519,000?
Yes.
Yeah, the amount paid off in debt.
Yes. Oh. Because
you can make that motion any second.
Yeah, I got that number memorized.
Yes.
I didn't.
I have a lot of the numbers memorized.
Do you mean, Michael, you just mean right off the top? Well,
right
you mean
the
in
top,
the debt
right
off the top.
Top. Right
okay.
The top.
All right. Does Mr. Pierce have a second?
$519,000.
Mr. Morrow seconded. Okay. Do you want...
Yeah.
Well, side conversations. We can't be talking.
Help the secretary.
Okay, but smile for a minute here. All right. Does anybody wish to discuss Mr. Pierce's motion reducing the total operating budget by $519,000?
Yeah, let's just vote.
Well, there's two or three reasons. Because in October, we had a surplus anticipated into the year of roughly $1 million. And then when we got to November, they said, oh, that's all horrible. That's not really true. It's only when we got to November, they said it was 700 and some thousand. But we, if you noticed on close examination, they paid the employee insurance twice in that month, which had never been done since at least going back to at least 2011. Okay, so what we have now is we're running along with a possible surplus at the year of $1 million. And last year, we had more or less the same thing. If you remember correctly, we had a big chunk of money left over, and they encumbered a bunch of things right at the end of the year. So based on that alone, plus the fact that the debt service went down by $500,000, and which will probably go up if any of these warrant articles pass, will probably go up even more than it went down,
I mean, I think it's only fair to the taxpayers we try to keep spending under control and go right back to what they said. They're only going to increase the budget by 1.1%. I think that's a wonderful idea. So that's the selling point. Yes.
Christy.
Yes.
What is the management's estimate for the balance in 2016?
I don't have my November financials, whatever was reported on, if someone has their November financials with them. I haven't done December numbers yet. It's only the 5th of the month. But whatever I said in November, that's what it was.
736,000.
If you
736,279.
Made double insurance payments in November.
Yeah. It's March. Possible that in November the December payment may have been posted. We never make double insurance.
So that made her forecast
go
down.
In November, if I do not catch it, my staff will end up paying the December bill or the next month's bill. Because it's due on the 1st, I usually make sure we hold it so that it doesn't reflect on the November financials. There is a possibility, I didn't go back and look, but there's a possibility that the December health insurance bill was paid in November. That is possible.
That was in a November finance report she gave us.
So
that's correct.
That might have been paid out of sequence, basically.
It could have been paid out of sequence. I won't say for sure because I don't have that in front
but
of me.
But you wouldn't send a second check for that same
bill. Not send
bill
a second check
in
for that.
December.
Is it possible that January will be paid in this
month? It is not because I just saw that in the bills for this week, and so it will have a January date. It was not paid in December. That one literally just came across my desk.
I have a suggestion. Let
yes,
Mike
sir.
Make that proposal at the deliberative session and see what happens.
I'm making it tonight.
I'm making it now.
I'm laying it down.
We've got a motion.
Okay.
We can
the budget committee can know
one,
the vote it up or down.
One more quick observation.
Right.
The $519,000 debt service was removed from the default, or has been removed,
yeah.
Right? So that's accounted for in that area.
Where do you propose to take the cut?
Oh, we're not going to get into that.
Well, he was
off
doing
the bottom line.
To go on the MS report.
Well, it has to pass this thing first, so.
Okay. You're all sufficiently disgusted there. So if I may call for a vote on Mike's motion, what are you doing?
Mr. Maher.
What?
He seconded Mike's
motion.
We're going to vote on it.
He made the second.
We're ready to vote.
I made a vote, too.
Okay, you understand the intent of Mr. Pierce's motion.
I moved the question.
For the fifth time, yes.
All right, Mr. Jones has moved the question, seconded by Mrs. Bridle?
Yep.
Excellent. Okay, in favor of moving the question?
Oh, wait.
Why are we moving the question? Why are we moving the question?
Just seconded
his. I know
his.
That.
Let's just
vote. Getting,
let's just vote.
Yes.
It's late. Vote on what?
Moving the question, vote.
Mike's motion.
Well, we discussed Mike's motion a little bit.
Now you have to vote.
And I seconded it.
Yes.
Let us vote on Mr. Pierce's motion now. All in favor
of eliminating 519,000.
The chairman has to ask for the vote. Please ask for the vote.
I try. Sometimes I really try,
okay,
Mr. LaBranche.
Just ask.
It's a good faith effort.
Good.
All right. Those in favor of the motion by Mr. Pierce to cut a lump sum off the bottom line of the 2017 operating budget in the amount of $519,000. In favor of that motion. Mr. Pierce, Mr. Maurer, opposed? Okay, abstaining? Mr. Kravitz and Mr. Jones are abstaining. Did we get everybody?
Mm-hmm. Can we vote now, Madam Chair?
We already did.
No, that was the motion from Mr. Pierce.
We just voted on Mike's motion to reduce it by 590.
Right.
Now we have to vote for the budget.
We voted for the budget.
No, we made the motion.
Wait, we did.
No confusion.
We did confirm the operating budget as approved by the budget committee, and then Mr. Pierce's motion came in after that, and it has not been passed.
Okay,
so we are standing on the amount that we approved for the totality of the 2017 budget.
In that case, Madam Chair, I move to adjourn.
At what time? I need the time.
At 9:40. p.m.
9:40 p.m. Seconded by Mr. Kravitz.
Before you do that, we might want to discuss, we're going to discuss our situation with our legal problem with this.
Oh, no, let's just,
no, we already decided she's going
to
go to the meeting.
I'll go and see the selectmen on Monday at some time or another.
You got a $2,000 line.
In favor of adjourning at 9:40 p.m., unanimous. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you.